It's already Tuesday, the 14th day of July, 2015. I'm your host, Alex Jones. Paul Joseph Watson is back from his investigation in Europe, back in London. He's going to be joining us on several huge topics. The fake ISIS beheading videos that have been revealed, the situation in Greece, this member of the Russian parliament or Duma, high level, coming out, breaking down that the negotiations are already going on with the Russian military and the oligarchs to remove Putin and break up Russia. And they're talking about that happening by August or September. Larry Elder, syndicated radio host, best-selling author, will be joining us to break down the race hype that's being pushed across the country. And I got to say something. The Ku Klux Klan and other white supremacist groups say they're going to go to Charleston this weekend, nearby the church, where 9 people were killed. And I do believe the people were killed there. The perpetrator looks like he might have been wound up. He was on an amnesiac drug. I said, look for that. If he's on an amnesiac, it may be staged. And sure enough, he was on one of the most powerful amnesiacs there is. Similar to what Sirhan was on, what they admit he was drugged up to then believe he had shot RFK. But side issue, I don't know if I'm going to send any reporters, but I'm tempted to. The problem is, and it's a good thing, the Klan doesn't show up most of the time they say they are, but a bunch of other rabble will. You know, it's one thing if you want to be a white supremacist or want to be a white separatist and that's your worldview. I don't agree with it, but I can respect your view and understand it, just like the black separatist of the Nation of Islam. But when you want to go gloat over dead people, it's just beyond the pale and disgusting. Now liberals will say, when I criticize them, that it's censorship. No, saying I disagree with them doing this is not censorship. Stopping them from doing it would be censorship. But that said, people should go get in their face under the First Amendment. It's like these people that go to dead veterans' funerals and then say you deserve to die because God hates fags. You use that slang term. And to say you died because the military's cursed now, as if it's their issue or as if it's their fault, even according to your perspective. I mean, it's trolling at the highest levels and is despicable and just feels like bad luck. I mean, the God-fearing side of me just cringes watching people do this type of stuff. Go to somebody's funeral that's done nothing to you and then add some other issue to it. It's almost like those groups are paid to do that. Ku Klux Klan plans to rally at South Carolina State House and then to march. NAACP commends South Carolina Confederate flag removal. And the Klan's idiocy makes the other idiocy of people actually thinking that the Confederate flag is evil and a symbol of slavery, it makes that look legitimate. And that's how this is done. So we'll be breaking all of that down coming up today. Robert Tosh Plumlee will be joining us, the current black ops contractor who's testified before Congress many times, one of the most famous whistleblowers who's alive. And you ask, how can he still be flying C-130s for the CIA and others? Because he never blew the whistle on something illegal. He's a hero. And a lot of folks in the government supporting. So he's back from some recent missions. He'll be joining us via video Skype. He was the first one to expose the Benghazi Stinger missiles and more. And now even Congress is covering it. He wants to talk about it. All right, strap yourselves in. It's going to be a power-packed, loaded transmission today. And we're going to be going live right into the fourth hour. Most stations carry just the first 3 hours. For years, I did 4 hours. And a lot of stations still carry the fourth hour. That's a re-air of the first hour. Or some stations carry the second, third, and fourth hour. It varies. But I am looking at bringing back, I will announce here on air, sometime this year, the fourth hour. But making the fourth hour an intense news broadcast with a fourth hour roundtable discussion where more than 50 news articles will be covered every day. Boom, boom, boom. Throw the topic out. Get a quick comment from the people on the panel. Take a call. Go to the next story. But I've been thinking about that for the last year. I've been quietly getting the reporters ready for it. They didn't even know. I've had them guest hosting and things like that. And I just do want to announce to our affiliates here in the next few weeks that we're going to be sending you a date. And of course, the satellite uplinks and the rest of it. The GCN feed, also our own satellite feed that we have on the same system, so that you can pick up that fourth hour of the radio/TV transmission. And that will be hosted by yours truly most days. I'll always be hosting the first 3 hours, but many days it will be hosted by the Round Table. So we're very, very excited. Talk about throwing the reporters and anchors into the deep end of syndicated radio. You know, they're a little nervous doing the news every night, but I've had them in here on the radio show. So trial by fire. I'll be the training wheels and be in here the first few months every day until they've gotten accustomed to it. And then some days that fourth hour will be hosted by the crew. And what made me think about it was I'm a guest occasionally on the Howard Stern show, which I like doing because it reaches so many people. And then I'm a more frequent guest on their after show roundtable and their news shows. And some of those are, in the aggregate, just as popular, at least segments of them are, as the Howard Stern program itself. That is, minute by minute, they have as many listeners. And so there's so much news we end up not getting to, so much news that breaks during the very end of the show, that I think that having a roundtable in here every day, and to have guest roundtables, to have folks that come in to co-host with us, who aren't even the reporters. So that is going to be coming up by the end of the year. We're going to be hiring a couple more reporters and anchors and camera people and video editors. That takes money. I never got into this, and I'm a capitalist and free market. I'm not ashamed to make money. I mean, if I write a fiction book that makes $1 billion, so be it. Nothing wrong with that. That's what makes the world go round. That's what innovates. But I never set out to have the syndicated radio broadcast to just make money. I needed money to fund it, but enemies tried to take me down. People tried to set me up. Dirty tricks were launched over and over again by government, corporations, individuals to try to stop us. They would always try to say, you just want to make money. So I said, you know what? Let me show you make money. I'll double, triple, quadruple, tenfold now our profits, what they were just 15 years ago. And then I will put almost all of it back in to the operation, because I have a love affair with the truth, a love affair with standing up to tyrants when they come after our children, our guns, our health, our sovereignty. And I'm going to show you what I can do, because big fish eat little fish. And I've had a lot of fish try to eat me. And now good luck doing it, because we have become quite large and are in the center of the zeitgeist. And everybody in the establishment knows it. Much of the public now knows it, and I'm not here bragging. It's a great responsibility. But when it comes to hardcore real politic, when it comes to hardcore talking about the issues, Infowars.com, this syndicated radio/TV transmission, is the heart of the resistance. And so I'm not going to sit back and lose this fight later and wish I hadn't put on all the sail I could, like a sailing ship. I'm going to put up every sail I can. I am going to get going as fast as I can to make this run at the globalists, and I'm not backing down, and I'm trusting in one thing alone, the Lord above. And part of the Lord above, our creator, is that good people have been created, and they have the spirit of liberty in their hearts as well. And when I say I count on God, I count on God's supporters, God's followers, God's worshipers, to understand what we're facing and to support this broadcast and to pray for us. And I know you do that, and so I want to salute all of you out there. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, people can say, before I get into all this news and tell you about the guests that are coming up, that why are you getting more and more religious? Well, it's been said many times, there are no atheists in foxholes. And when you read about babies wrapped in gold foil being shipped out of China by the thousands every month and being turned into powder for women mainly to eat it, believing it makes them look younger, and nobody seems to care. When you look at hundreds of millions of abortions every year worldwide, when you look at the globalists poisoning our food and water supply by design and forcing Gardasil shots on young girls all over the planet, when you look at our government funding ISIS and Al-Qaeda, when you look at the borders wide open and El Chapo, now we learn, had his wife move here to have her baby so he'd have an anchor baby. The billionaire drug dealer even lives off U.S. taxpayers. I mean, it's a joke. And so that's why I'm committed to fight as hard as I can. The British Special Forces slogan for the Special Air Services, the model of Special Forces worldwide, I mean, they were the first to do it, SAS, is fortune favors the bold. Well, I'm here to tell you, in the face of them coming after our guns, coming after our health, coming after everything, fortune favors the bold. What is our fortune? What made our fortune? What made the prosperity and the freedom? Our forebears didn't back down. They refused to be downtrodden. A lot of them came from indentured servitude, slavery, you name it. But they persevered to the point we're at. And our ancestors aren't losers. Whether you're black, whether you're white, whether you're Hispanic or Asian, all peoples of the earth have incredible histories of incredible adversity and overcoming it. And that's why we're here today. The fact that your parents and their grandparents and their great-great-great-great-grandparents were able to have children and have them survive and pass that torch forward, and the fact that we're alive today as a species and dominant on this planet is because we're winners. And I'm sick of people telling us we're not winners. You are a winner. You are special. Consciousness is incredible. An incredible God made you, whether you believe in God or not. Look around you. Reality's fantastic. 12 dimensions they've discovered. Scientists believe there's probably life in other dimensions. What do you think all this is? We only see a very narrow spectrum of light, just in the light spectrum of this dimension. The eye has not seen, the ear has not heard what God, the universe, whatever you want to call it, has in store for us. And we're not going to let the globalist wall off reality, put us in a matrix to control us, dumb us down, and then phase us out like we're a horse and buggy whip in 1920 and the factories are closing because nobody buys buggies and buggy whips and horses anymore. We are the innovators. We are the great creation. We are in the image of the great creator. We are special. We are powerful. And that's why the fallen one on this planet wants to bring us down. And the reason I get more and more spiritual is because I realize that's where the real fight is. And I realize that that's the only way we're going to beat the enemy is with a force greater and more powerful and stronger. You are not going to beat something from the same energy level. You're going to have to go above it. You're going to have to go around it. And the enemy knows that, and that's why they had to make us godless first. They had to take over the churches. I mean, the most evil doctrines you can imagine are taught in these churches now. Across the board. And I'm no Pharisee or Sadducee up here claiming I've got all the answers. I know I can see evil. I know I can see it growing. I know the devil has captured the church in the world. From the Catholic Church to the Protestant Church, speaking the literal doctrine of Satan. One world government, planetary rule, collectivism, all the rest of it. And this just shows us how we're 2 minutes to midnight. And I will assure all the Christianoids out there of something very important. The fact that you think you're covered when you don't go out and fight the tyranny and you don't go out and warn people, I know in my heart, I don't say this to judge you, I know in my heart that my God-fearing conscience, the minute I even think about backing down from the New World Order, my soul goes, you don't want to do that or you're going to be made separate from God. You call that hell. Being in the presence of all these evil people, your energy, your spirit going into that dimension, that's hell. Being around all these losers for eternity, you want to be resonating, to use a modern term, people can understand, into that spectrum? No, no, no. I don't want to go there. I don't want to spend any time there. And my spirit says, if you're not fighting tyranny, this is my experience. Yours may be different. If you're not resisting the oppression of innocence, and if you're screwing people over, and if you're passively going along with it, that you are going to be cut off from God. Now, I'm done preaching. I'm going to stop. We got Paul Watson with huge breaking news joining us. We've got Larry Elder, always dynamic and informative, on the race war they're trying to start. Robert Tosh Plumlee, CIA contractor, top Iran Contra whistleblower, still works for the CIA and the Army. He's coming on with bombshell intel. This is all coming up. So stay with us, ladies and gentlemen. Infowars.com, prisonplanet.tv. Stay with us. Big broadcast, obviously. We're 24 minutes into this transmission. I went off on a rant about the state of the world. Basically, evil is people and ideas and systems that cheat God's system, the world's biological system, our spiritual system, and basically contaminate things with what I'd call galactic mental illness. Not treating others as you want to be treated. Not realizing that everything you do ends up coming back onto you. And that's just my gut-level philosophy. And the globalists are cheating all of that, believing they're going to transcend humanity and become gods. There's no way you're going to transcend anything without going through the steps God has set up for us. And just common sense says that. We have more information than the world's ever had, more of it at our fingertips, and people have never been as ignorant. That's an example of not appreciating things. I mean, my parents were middle class growing up, and I mean, if I had a pair of cowboy boots that wore out, they'd always buy something a couple sizes too big and tell me to wear, you know, big socks so that I could keep the boots a couple years, and if the heels wore out, they went and got them repaired. And then we would go give them to somebody who was younger than me when they were too small. And I got maybe two pairs of shoes a year. I remember all the other kids in my neighborhood got two pairs of shoes a year. When my dad was a kid, he got one pair of shoes a year. And now my kids are great kids. They're sweet. But I catch myself just at the mall. Yeah, let's just go get some shoes. And I'm looking in their closet and they got like 10 pairs of shoes. And then they can never seem to find their shoes. Or they don't like their shoes. It's not that they're bad kids. They're decadent like me compared to my predecessors because they have been in such abundance. So I made the decision to try to institute things where, no, these are your two pairs of shoes, and they get put back here, and we hang your clothes here, and we appreciate these, and we keep them clean. And you're going, yeah, that's common sense. It's how you raise a kid. I know. But if you look at society, everyone just throws their kid a Nintendo handheld or a Game Boy or the more modern systems on a smartphone. And I go to a restaurant and every child, I mean, almost every child. In fact, I've shot videos of it on my iPhone, speak of the devil, and meant to do a whole piece on it. There's a whole bunch of them on my phone. I should give it to Buckley, have them pulled off. And it's just videos of kids looking at the screen and never talking to their parents. And then I'll kind of walk behind him and get a shot from behind because I don't want to show kids' faces on TV. But the answer is just blur their faces out. And I can just show the parents talking to each other. They're the last generation, I guess, to do that. And then the kids aren't talking. They're on their phones. And now adults are doing this. And look, I know I'm stating the obvious. It's obvious that no one should drink tap water because glyphosate is in 99% of every municipal water supply source. FDA, EPA. Look it up for yourself. Glyphosate grows pancreatic cancer, kidney cancer, bladder cancer, urinary tract cancer, and it's in 99% of the water supplies, EPA.gov. And in very dangerous levels in major cities. But rural areas, it's even worse. It's being spread on the crops. And I know we all know that, but I still catch myself. I'll be up at 3 in the morning going to the bathroom. I walk over, I forgot to bring a bottle of water up, and I'll just, because I put purified water in a bottle of water, use it as a container, I'll just catch myself at the sink just drinking tap water. And at 3 a.m., I just go, I don't care, I want it, I don't want to go downstairs. And I'm just like, I need to be disciplined. And it's fun to be disciplined. I've been getting more disciplined in little increments, and I enjoy being disciplined. And sure, you can get too disciplined and become completely OCD. But those of us that are the opposite of OCD, we need to start trying to become more OCD and try to become a little more neurotic about putting our clothes up, putting our toothbrush up, doing that. Because if we can't do that, we're not going to tell our kids, no, you can't have television. We're going to go play a board game, or we're going to go paint, or we're going to go for a walk at night outside. The full moon's out. We're going to go hunt rabbits with a spotlight. Or you just go out at night for fun and have the private eyes that are following you try to catch you. Anyways, the whole point is that life is such an adventure. Stay with us. All right. I want to go to Paul Watson joining us from London. And again, the globalists have us chasing all the diversions, all the distractions, all their fiat currency. The real fortune to be had is freedom and a relationship with the creator of the universe and being able to raise your own family and to associate with who you wish and to engage in the great animating contest of liberty. And it's true that fortune favors the bold. If your fortune that you're looking for is freedom, and if you refuse to comply with tyranny, you will live in a freer society, and you will then consequently be wealthy, you will be successful, you will be empowered. And it depends on what wealth you're looking for. A wealth of friends, a wealth of ideas, a wealth of enjoyment, camaraderie, an honorable life. There are so many forms of wealth. And the globalists have made us very poor indeed when the average American doesn't know what Independence Day is, or 19% of Americans know what the First Amendment is in a new national poll. Here is some of the news that's coming up. Ku Klux Klan plans rally in South Carolina State House. They have a right to do it. I have a right to say it is horrible. It is distasteful. It is sickening, just like going to dead vets' funerals and injecting your anti-gay marriage agenda. What does that have to do with that? It is meant to absolutely inflame people's emotions, obviously. Coming up, food stamp beneficiaries have exceeded 45 million for 48 straight months. New economic numbers. The new federal tax revenue coming in through June so far is $2,446,920,000,000, a record level, but still the feds run a $313 billion deficit. They will spend any amount of money that we bring in because the bankers want us insolvent to take us over. Continuing, ladies and gentlemen, 10 horribly violent crimes that were committed by illegal immigrants just recently, a Michael Schneider article at Infowars.com. We're going to hit some of those. Globalist assault on tax competition rouses opposition. Global governments being formed. The New American, Alex Newman, breaks it down. And there is massive pressure to force governments around the world to unify taxes at above 80% federal alone. That's why in France, the average person pays over 90% in taxes. Some people over 100% to impoverish them. That's a Forbes headline, by the way, 101% in France. So we're going to be getting into that. Obama readies a transgender military. If that won't break up the military, nothing will. Now they're going to have studies, and now they're going to have a fund to help people transition men who are in the military to, I guess, be women or be something else. And I mean, my issue is, they've already lowered the size of the pack in the Marines and the Army so that the average female recruit can carry it. I can't carry a 65-pound pack 30 miles in one day. I probably might have been able to do it when I was 20. And I ran 6 miles every other day and could bench press 360 pounds, squat 600 pounds. you know, do deadlifts with 400 pounds. And I'm not saying I was the biggest guy around or the toughest, but I mean, I could skin a buck, run a trot line, and I couldn't go do that right off the bat. And that's what more of the advanced courses do. Boot camp doesn't do that, but then that's what you do later. And I mean, just the average woman can't do that. It's just statistically, there's not many men that can do it proficiently. But hey, we'll just make that pack 20 pounds, pumpkin. Think you can do that now? Obama readies a... How about I get to have a baby? How about all women get arrested because they're discriminating against me because the fact that they can have a baby makes me feel bad that I can't? Because they tell boys and girls the word boys and girls is hurtful, so you got to be a purple penguin. By the way, they're now calling to take a Confederate general off one of these murals they put on the side of a mountain. And I told you, next will be get rid of Mount Rushmore. New articles out. Taxpayers have now spent $3.5 million to fund why lesbians are three times fatter than average women. Democrat judge orders psych counseling for D'Souza, who was in prison for 9 months, for getting five of his friends to give campaign donations that I believe were legal. If you read the law, Hillary can take money from foreign dictators, though. And the judge said he believes he's mentally ill because he believes he's being persecuted by the government. And so there you go. He has to go to psych eval. And he's been told under probation, don't do interviews. By the way, that's a little inside baseball. By the way, I knew when D'Souza was going to be indicted 2 days before it happened. Because a little bird that was in Hollywood with the folks that were editing his next movie was there. And they were just shocked by it. And they had feds following the crew around as harassment. I mean, it gets old. And believe me, when you're sitting there with your kids at a restaurant having dinner and you look up and a guy's taking photos of you and smiles at you and sticks their chin out at you, you're just like, man, this government's really screwed up. Like, not only is the Fed doing it, they're trying to intimidate you because they're Democratic Party sicko operatives and they hate anybody who isn't left of Mao Zedong. Here it is. NAACP wants Stone Mountain Confederate General sandblasted off. Paul Joseph Watson wrote about that. European agency to review HPV vaccine side effects. Oh, that's the main effect because India and Japan have banned it. It's killing people and maiming them. That's mainstream news. We're going to be getting to that report. HAARP to be transferred to civilian control. We'll still have Pentagon funding. That's just some of what's coming up on that front. There's just so much news. The latest on Russia, the latest on the Middle East. I want to talk to Paul Watson in a moment about two bombshell articles. He's joining us via video Skype from London. But before we do that, briefly, it was sold out for 2 weeks. We got a limited run back in, as you know. It will sell out at current sales rates. Weldon and shipping and inventory said 2 weeks. He's being conservative. I believe it'll be sold out in 1 week, and then we don't know when we'll get any more. That's just a fact. The highest quality nation iodine, the purest. I've taken other purified iodines. They worked very well. This has been over the top for me and my family. It will be sold out like the other seven products. Survival Shield X2 is selling out. Less than 1 week supply left in my view. Our latest emergency run of Survival Shield X2 is about to completely sell out. It looks like we'll be out by early next week. Last month, we received, again, a shipment in after it had been sold out. Now is the time to stock up on X2 with free shipping in the month of July on all orders to InfoWarsLife.com. Survival Shield X2 Nation Iodine is ultra clean, ultra powerful, and it's derived from our limited supply of deep earth crystals. All the rest is sea-based. Plus, it funds our operation. It's a 360 win across the board. Get your X2 Nation Iodine from InfoWarsLife.com today while supplies last. And it's a bittersweet bummer because the fact that it's selling out sells it, but then it's really high quality. It funds the operation, but then it's a bummer to not know when we're getting more back in. Also, Super Male Vitality will sell out in the next 2 weeks. So will Super Female Vitality, but it looks like more will be in within a month or so. So we'll just be sold out for a few weeks on that. But if you want it, it's available free shipping right now at InfoWarsLife.com and InfoWarsStore.com. And Prostaguard sold out, as you know, for about 2.5 months. It is back in, the strongest formula with 10 ingredients, 3 of them certified and admitted to be good for your prostate, even by the government. And most products, you can't say that, but Purified, Saw Palmetto, read about the other 9 ingredients. There's an informational video up on the site and a breakdown of it, InfoWarsLife.com. And it just does amazing things to block the BPA. I don't really know everything it exactly does. I'm not a chemist. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a biologist. I'm not a, it's well known. You can go read all the medical literature about saw palmetto, but that's just one of the ingredients. Vitamin D, zinc, selenium, copper, magnesium, chromium, molybdenum, plant sterol, saw palmetto, berry powder, and lycopene, they say, all our experts, even more important than the saw palmetto. And it all fuses together in the digestive tract to have an upload of it, is what the experts tell me. InfoWarsLife.com. Now, joining us from London, England, is Paul Joseph Watson with a breakdown of 2 bombshell articles he's put out in the last 24 hours. U.S., and when they say U.S., globalists in control of the U.S., because they're running us in the ground as well with economic war, while they consolidate power outside the nation state. U.S. conspiring with Russian oligarchs to overthrow Putin, says Duma member. Well, when I heard him speak for 25 minutes, that's how long the speech is, or the interview, everything he says is actually open source true. So see, I don't just believe this guy. And then it continues, who is behind the staged ISIS beheading video? Bizarre footage reportedly released by Russian hackers. And if they did stage the video of the video, they deserve Oscars because it looks exactly like the original background. I remember saying that very beheading had to be staged. I'm not saying ISIS isn't killing people, because it was cinematic. It looked more real than reality. It was so well done. It looked like something Stanley Kubrick would come out with. I mean, it looked too real, more real than real. And then now you have it filmed from a distance that an ambassador's aide shot. That's exactly how they do it. And you can see them in there producing it. And we know, you know, they don't have an army of 7-foot guys chopping 5-foot people's heads off, marching them by the beach. I mean, it's or with perfect sand dunes and a background that you know isn't real. Because there's something about fake film cinema that looks like magic. You know what I mean? And we should do a whole piece where we show the beheadings. Well, then they censor us. Or we just show still shots of it to break it down. So Paul Watson will go over that as well. And his latest article, where they may move to pull down Mount Rushmore next. But before we go any further, Paul, which one of these do you want to tackle first?
Well, let's start with the Mount Rushmore thing, because that's the one that came out this morning. So basically, this is the NAACP in Atlanta. They're now literally calling for this Stone Mountain Monument, which is the largest bas relief structure sculpture in the world. This is iconic and historic. It's bigger than a football field. It's bigger than Mount Rushmore. It took decades and decades to complete. It wasn't even completed until 1972 because they kept having to go back to complete it. So they're now literally calling for it to be sandblasted off the face of this mountain in the name of political correctness.
This sounds like the Taliban blowing up Buddhist idols.
Well, exactly, Alex. I've been saying for months that so-called progressives are moving ideologically closer to ISIS terrorists, because for a year, ISIS have been destroying historical statues and monuments that, quote, offend their radical ideology, which is now exactly what's happening with leftists. You know, there was a video about a week ago where they did a man on the street thing, this media organization, and they said, you know, Washington, D.C., it's named after George Washington. He owned slaves. Should we rename Washington, D.C.? And the majority of the people, who, of course, also think that Beyonce should have the right to ban the First Amendment because of racism, said, yes, we should change the name of Washington, D.C. and call it Black City or Mixed Race City and all these other ridiculous terms. So it's actually getting to that level. Of course, we had a CNN discussion last month in the light of this Charleston shooting where they said, you know, when do we get to the point where we call for the removal of statues of Thomas Jefferson? And Don Lemon and this other host on CNN were having a rational, sober debate about actually yanking down Jefferson statues and monuments in Washington, D.C. So now they're talking about doing the same in Georgia. And of course, Memphis City Council, as you reported, just voted to dig up the dead body of the Confederate General Nathan Bedford Forrest, move it to a different location and sell off his statue to the highest bidder. So again, we make the point. This is the translation of this social justice warrior mental illness that's been raging on social media for years and years. Now it's actually translating into law and physical action because politics is downstream from culture. So whatever they set up the cultural narrative to be, which after this Charleston shooting is, you know, any representation of the Confederate flag is racist and evil, they're now translating that into actual council votes, legislature votes and laws, which will physically remove from the pages of history this iconic art, whatever you think about it, just as ISIS terrorists are doing across the Middle East.
Well, I agree with you, Paul Watson. You want to get into the Russia situation or get into the ISIS situation?
We'll get into the ISIS situation. One more thing on that, though. You know, you can go through that throughout the world. Every single country had slavery. You know, the Chinese had slaves. In fact, Chinese slaves built the Terracotta Army, which is this much celebrated, you know, life-size figures of these Terracotta warriors. That was
the Aztec temples were built by the underclass slaves. As slavery's in the Bible. I mean, Abraham had slaves. That's just what went on.
So
and usually it meant it was a rich guy, a rich guy that could pay for an armored house, and everybody lived in the walls there. I'm not defending slavery. It's just an institution that went on. But again, guilt is a powerful manipulator. Sorry.
Yeah, you know, the Egyptians used slaves to build the pyramids. Are we going to destroy the pyramids?
I think we should.
Yeah, the cotton economy was built on slavery. Are we going to ban cotton? iPhones are made by slaves in China. Should we ban iPhones? They only target these bastions of so-called white Western culture because that's what they're currently trying to overturn.
They're targeting Robert E. Lee because he was the commandant of West Point. His grandfather and was his right-hand man of George Washington, not his father. And he was probably one of the greatest field generals ever. They think he was better than Napoleon. We're not defending Napoleon. It was just he was a master military person. And Stonewall Jackson was probably even better than Lee. And the South's military, it was like one of the best in history. I mean, that's just a fact.
And now there's even a story out of England where they're talking about banning any representation of chains or shackles. They're having a celebration because this area in England called the Black Country created these chains back in the 18th century. Now they're saying any representation of chains is racist and must be banned.
It's about them controlling reality, being able to ban whatever they want, pure totalitarian cult. Some of the articles on Infowars.com. Flag purge continues. NAACP wants stars and bars removed from Alabama troopers' vehicles. John McCain responds to stage ISIS beheading video. Obama readies a transgender military. HAARP to be transferred to civilian control. It's all coming up. Paul, I want to shift gears out of political correctness in the time we have. But briefly, why do you think it's getting so over the top now? I mean, clearly it's not a mental illness by the social engineers. If they can ban symbols and ban speech, they have control and they've ended the most key component of freedom.
That's exactly it. They've become emboldened since this Charleston shooting. And now they're just going hell for leather with this hysteria. I mean, we had an article yesterday about the no flagging challenge. This is literally people violating private property rights, going onto people's homes, tearing down Confederate flags and putting it up on Vine and YouTube. Now we're getting reports of people being threatened at gunpoint for having Confederate flags flying from their house. So if you think about it, is it really a great idea for people to go and violate private property, attack private property in southern states where these people are going to be armed? They're going to have guns. They're going to end up getting shot. Is that really a great idea? But now actually people threatening people at gunpoint for having Confederate flags on their own property, not even trying to confront people, just having them attached to their house. We're now getting reports of that. So again, if they want to gin up this racial confrontation, that's exactly what they're going to get. It's just going to end in more bloodshed.
Well, we know that whether this shooting in Charleston was completely staged or completely real, this whole race war atmosphere contributed to this mentally ill person who got his gun illegally. He got it through the instant check, but for some reason that didn't stop him. But regardless, it sets a precedent where anybody can commit a crime cloaked in its image and then you ban it. I mean, this is just mindless, but they're certainly turning the heat up right now, Paul.
Well, yeah, and the funny thing is it's the Streisand effect, isn't it? The past 3 weeks, I've never seen more Confederate flags than in my entire life. So in the name of banning it, it's just become more apparent. Again, emboldening white supremacists who might be inspired to go out and violently attack people, emboldening extreme leftists on the other side, you know, the Black Lives Matter people who were now getting reports of threatening people at gunpoint for having the Confederate flag. So this is not having the effect of harmony and positive race relations. It's having the exact opposite.
Well, I'll be honest with you. It almost makes me want to stick one on my car. Just because they're trying to ban it. I mean, I've never been into the rebel flag, never had it, never had it. But at the same time, they're trying to ban it. And it was an honorable flag when it was made. And just the idea of banning history because people get freaked out about it, it's just crazy. I almost want to just have therapy with them and walk around with a big, we should send our reporters downtown with battle flags and ask folks their opinion of it and just get the ignorance because it's crazy, Paul.
Yeah, and sales are exploding just like gun sales explode when they try to ban them. It has the same effect every time. It's backfiring.
Now, we're going to come back and just have 5 minutes with you before Larry Elder. I want to get into the Russia situation and this new video that purports to show them staging one of the ISIS beheadings. The videos are clearly staged, but is this video of the staging real? Or is it a fake? Coming up at 40 after, David Knight joins us with breaking news. We've got a lot of great reporters. We're going to start having them sometimes not in studio with me here in the war room, but in Studio B. And we have Studio C getting set up. So David Knight with breaking news will be joining us coming up. Jade Helm kicks off tomorrow. Joe Biggs, Jakari Jackson, and others are going to be on the ground covering it. But right now, let's go back to Paul Watson. Paul Watson finishing up with this latest video. Who is behind the staged ISIS beheading video was your article. What do you think is going on?
Well, this was released over the weekend by a pro-Russian hacktivist group, which is based in Ukraine, called Cyber Berkut. And obviously, as you've seen from the video, it shows a film set with a scene that's made to look like desert scenery. Two professional cameras recording it, a lighting rig. It all looks very professional. So they claim that it was hacked from an aide to John McCain, hacked from his, quote, electronic device during a recent trip to Ukraine. That prompted McCain to come out last night and state on Twitter, another nutty conspiracy theory from Russian internet trolls. I'm very proud to be target of America's enemies. So the speculation is, you know, was this created by a conspiracy theorist to create buzz on the internet? Was it produced by the Russian hackers themselves, which seems like the most likely explanation? Or is it taken from some kind of theatrical production or movie? We know that a film out of Turkey depicted an ISIS beheading, so it could be one of those three. It seems more likely to be an attempt to embarrass John McCain, because in this tweet, he also talks about, oh, they doctored photos of me meeting with ISIS leaders. There was some speculation about that when he met with Syrian rebels.
But by the way, he defended those visits against Senator Paul 3 years ago and 2 years ago and admitted it and said, I'm proud of it. You should meet with him too. So he's been caught in a big lie. I wasn't aware that he did that, Paul. Wow. I mean, I know he responded, but I hadn't read your article yet because it just came out. That is huge. Do you have it in the article? Because my memory serves. McCain admitted he met with him.
No, we've got the photo in the article where he's meeting with Abdel Hakim Belhaj, who was the guy they empowered armed to overthrow Gaddafi in Libya. He's now the leader of ISIS in Libya. And McCain was pictured with Lindsey Graham, presenting him with an award. So yes, he has been pictured with actual ISIS leaders. He also met with those Syrian rebels who later defected to Jabhat al-Nusra, and these are the jihadist groups who are almost as barbarous as ISIS. So again, yeah, that smacks of desperation. He has to draw attention to that when it's been proven that he has met with ISIS leaders like Belhaj. So it's very interesting that he would even mention that in this context.
But Paul, if you go back to when that happened 3 years ago, he defended it on the news and said, of course I'm listening to the rebels. You know, I've got courage to go in there and do this. So he's on record admitting it and defending it. And now I just saw his tweet saying he didn't meet with them. He is incredibly arrogant.
No, he's being caught in a flat out lie once again, but it doesn't seem to have bothered him in the past. But again, the question is, if this was a fake ISIS-headed, why would they be off filming it in the background? If it was a top secret operation, why would they allow that footage to even exist in the first place? Which is why people are saying this is an attempt by the Russians to frame McCain, to frame the US in general as being behind ISIS, which we don't need the conspiracy theories to prove that, because we know, you know, they were trained in Jordan. Many of America's top allies are funding them, have been funding them. Those mysterious airdrops of weapons from the US that always end up in ISIS hands. Sure. So those are the real facts that prove that.
Well, all I'm saying is I've seen one of the beheadings where it was in the desert and it looked fake, and it looks like the same background. So whoever staged this, if it is staged, did a really good job of what I've seen in the fake beheading videos. And we know some of the beheading videos we've seen have been cinematically shot, pointing towards the fact they're staged. Thank you, Paul Watson. Great job. More of your articles on PrisonPlanet.com. Larry Elder is a best-selling author, syndicated radio host, and a really smart fella. LarryElder.com is one of his websites. He joins us for the next 40 minutes or so. Then David Knight will join us from our Situation Room with some breaking news and some analysis. And then we've got a CIA whistleblower on Benghazi with breaking information, Tosh Plumlee, joining us in the third hour. Look at this story out of Breitbart. Mexican drug lord El Chapo, the guy tweeting at Donald Trump saying, I'm going to get you, told his wife to give birth to anchor babies in the U.S. so they'd be U.S. citizens and could be paid for. So isn't that just special? And doesn't that illustrate everything that Donald Trump is saying? You cannot make this type of stuff up. I mean, I can't go to Mexico with a woman, my wife or whoever, and just have a baby for free. They'd laugh at me. And then have the baby get welfare. But because Obama says America has racism in its DNA, well, we want to show we're not, so we're going to pay for it all. I mean, it's a joke. And then Donald Trump is saying things that are true, and the media acts like he's saying incredibly insane things. And that's what Larry Elder is here to talk with us about. But now the NAACP wants Stone Mountain Confederate generals sandblasted off Mount Rushmore. So they want that blasted off. What's next, Mount Rushmore? Well, I said it before Rush Limbaugh. And I said it before, and I'm not bragging, I'm just, I don't say this stuff as hyperbole, and I said it before Louis Farrakhan. On record a week before, I said, are they going to ban the American flag? Because it flew over indentured servants, slaves, you name it. Every flag more than 200 years old flew over slaves. I mean, the Bible, the Old Testament, everybody had slaves. Black Africans had slaves. People in the Middle East had slaves. I'm not defending, and I have no connection to it. Most white people that have come here came here after slavery. Their great-grandparents did. I mean, it's just, it's this crazy guilt that, I'll be honest, I grew up with some of it, which I guess since we were close to some bad stuff in the past, it was good to, like, be aware of it. But now, jumping the shark, don't have brown bags in Seattle, and the name Mom and Dad is hurtful, so get rid of it on government documents, and boys and girls at public schools can't be called that because some people aren't boys or girls, so you're purple penguins. And telling a minority, you know, good job, they tell the faculty, don't do that, it's condescending. It's turning us into mentally ill basket cases. But still worse, it's causing a backlash and making people that weren't racist then project the political correctness onto people not understanding it's the political class engaging in this. That's my view on it. We're going to get Larry Elder's take on it now. But I tell you, Larry, I see this stuff going on the news, and I can't even believe it. It's so ridiculous. It's like satire. It's like a Monty Python episode. I mean, does the controlled crazy left realize how whacked out they are? I mean, they're running things. They must know what they're doing. What's happening here?
No, they don't realize it. And Alex, thank you very much for having me on. 95% of black voters voted for Barack Obama, and the black economic condition is worse off than when Obama took office. Black income is down. Black net worth is down about a third over the last few years. The so-called wealth gap between whites and blacks is the widest it's been in 25 years. I don't know what more Obama could have done to the black economy other than take a baseball bat to it. And still, he is celebrated by black voters. I don't get it. The primary problem in America is not police officers going after black people. It's not the Confederate flag. It is the implosion of the black family. Back in 1965, 25% of black kids were born outside of wedlock. Now, Alex, the number is over 70%. I didn't say this. Obama said it. If you grow up without a dad, you are 5 times more likely to be poor, 9 times more likely to drop out of school, 20 times more likely to end up in jail. Do the math. Why are we talking about that? How do we go from 9 innocent worshipers in Charleston being murdered by this guy to a discussion about the Confederate flag? It is just bizarre. And in 1963, Alex, 4 black kids were bombed in Birmingham, and that time, George Wallace was the governor of Georgia, the one who said segregation now, segregation forever. The chief cop was a guy that sicked water hoses and dogs on black people. The Klan was so virulent, they called Birmingham Bombingham because there were 2 or 3 bombings just that very week. Fast forward to now, the South Carolina governor is a woman of Indian descent. One of the 2 senators is a black person, and we're still talking about racism in America? Give me a break. This is not your grandfather's America, for crying out loud.
And I guess the controlled left uses race to manipulate people and to divert off the real issues. And so they're desperate to, I guess, reassert it on a new generation to create more division. I mean, what are they trying to do?
That's exactly what they're trying to do. They can't talk about economic growth because this recovery has been the worst one, arguably, we've ever had, certainly the worst one since the Second World War. So let's divert attention. Let's talk about racism. Let's talk about Rachel Dolezal. Let's talk about the Confederate flag. Let's talk about anything other than the damage the left has done to the black family, to the inner cities, to black income. Alex, I wrote a book called Dear Father, Dear Son, and I urge your listeners to just read the reviews before you decide to buy the book. It's about my father, who did not know his biological father.
No, I've read the book. I couldn't put it down. I read it a couple years ago when it came out.
Thank you. He grew up in the Jim Crow South, and he got kicked out of the house by his mother when he was 13 years old, never to return. And my father was a Republican, and he believed that the biggest thing that happened negatively to black America was the welfare state. And my father told my brothers and me, don't listen to other people talk about how horrible the country is, because it's substantially different than it was when I grew up. Hard work wins. You get out of life what you put into it. And while you can't control the outcome, you are 100% in control of your effort. And before you bitch and moan and whine about what the man has done to you, go to the mirror, look into the mirror, and find out whether or not you could have done something to have altered the outcome. That's what my dad told my brothers and me. That's what I believe now. But Obama has convinced black people that they're victims, and that those guys over there, the Tea Partiers, Republicans, black Republicans, they're victimizers. And by the way, we're the rescuers. We're there in the white hat, on the white horse. We're going to come in, and we're going to give you social justice. Never mind economic growth. Never mind the implosion of the black family. Never mind the implosion of black home equity. Never mind black home ownership down. Never mind any of the other metrics I just now gave you. Let's call America inherently racist, say it's in our DNA, and convince black people to pull that lever 95% for us. And by the way, Alex, if racism is in our DNA, how do you go from 1960, according to Gallup, 60% of Americans said they would never vote for a black president, no matter how qualified. Obama, of course, gets elected in 2008, gets reelected in 2012, despite a lousy economic recovery and unpopularity of Obamacare. In 1955, only 4% of whites and blacks in America said that they approved of black-white marriages. And now 87% of Americans approve of black white marriages. So if it's in our DNA, how do those things change? It's nonsense. Obama got a higher percentage of the white vote than John Kerry did. Did Kerry whine about being affected by racism because he didn't get the majority of white votes? It's outrageous what the left has done to convince black people that they are victims, that racism remains a major problem in America when it is not. And by the way, pull the lever for the left wing party, because we're going to fight social justice on your behalf. It is outrageous.
My problem is there's no doubt the Republicans have a better platform and better, more Americana ideas that'll make us a successful country and what made us so great. And they're the party that helped end slavery. They're the party that passed the Civil Rights Act. It is an inverted reality that we see here. But the Republican leadership now goes along with the Democrats and never really calls Obama out on what they're doing. And so until that happens, I don't think this country has a prayer, because I grew up in Dallas, Texas, and, you know, going to high school there, I mean, probably a third of the high school or more was black, and most, you know, my friends in sports and stuff were black. There was some racism back and forth, but that was mainly between hillbillies and who were racist and black folks that were racist, but it wasn't anything like it is now, where you're just bombarded with it. I mean, it is just insane.
Yeah, the Republican Party, interesting that Eric Holder said that America, when it comes to race, is a nation of cowards. I would say the Republican Party, when it comes to race, is a party of cowards. Instead of saying what I just now said, it's, oh, I once marched with Martin Luther King 50 years ago. I care. What you ought to be talking about is the damage the left has done to the black middle class, the damage things like race-based preferences have done. They've created a higher dropout rate among black students. They get in under race-based preferences. They ought to be talking about the damage done to the city through urban renewal and through forced busing. They ought to be talking about these lousy government schools where 50% of blacks drop out of school and those who graduate cannot read, write, and compute at grade level. Instead, we're talking about what the white man has done and the Confederate flag and nonsense that has nothing whatever to do with the current plight of the black middle class.
Well, I think you've really hit the nail on the head there when you talk about they've taken our basic freedoms, they've taken our economic future, they've taken our jobs, and then all they give us is identity politics. That's why they're now drilling down into saying transgender, don't say dad and mom, right. Don't say husband and wife, don't say boy or girl. They're doing this with a straight face to just kill any identity that isn't just worshiping the state.
And that is why, Alex, Trump is resonating. And if I were Trump, I'd broaden the argument. He has not made the argument that illegal aliens pose a threat to job prospects of people living in the inner city. A friend of mine is named Peter Kersenow. He sits on the U.S. Civil Rights Commission. He's black, and he said that all three sectors of the commission, moderates, conservatives, and liberals, agreed to a letter they sent to Marsha Fudge, a woman who's on the Congressional Black Caucus, and said, what's going on? Why aren't you stopping these porous borders? You're threatening the jobs and the promotions of inner city people, most of whom are black people. And he said he hasn't even heard back. So what Donald Trump should be talking about, in addition to talking about the illegality, is the threat that illegal aliens pose to the job prospects of people living in the inner city.
Sure, and nothing against the people pouring across wanting a better life, but here's the bottom line. A lot of them are criminals fleeing justice, and that's a fact. But more importantly, they are colonizing the former black areas and pushing the blacks out and taking the jobs. That's why the unemployment doubled. You're listening to The Alex Jones Show. I'm your host, Alex Jones, syndicated radio host, best-selling author. Larry Elder is our guest. Till about 40 after. This is a short segment. We'll be back with us in the next segment. ElderStatement.com, LarryElder.com are his websites. Larry, I want to get into the Donald Trump phenomenon, because the mainstream media wouldn't be saying his name thousands of times a day and misrepresenting what he's saying if they didn't have a plan. And I think it is to distract from the other Republican candidates thinking that Trump isn't serious, is going to drop out later. That's just what my gut's saying. But regardless, he's saying things that are true, so he has to be defended. But I know he's a really smart guy. He doesn't seem to defend himself very well in the way he's responding to a lot of this, but you were getting into black unemployment that, as you were just saying, has doubled the last 7 years. And there's incredible friction between the immigrant community that's mainly Hispanic and blacks. That's in local news. Where do you see all this going?
Well, I disagree. I think Donald Trump has been defending himself just fine by not apologizing, by not backing down the way Republicans normally do. Recall when Todd Akin said legitimate rape, all he was saying is some women, in fact, lie about rape. Not very many do, but about 10% apparently do. All of a sudden, Rance Priebus dumped on him, and Todd Akin got destroyed in the election. Donald Trump has not backed down. He's not afraid of being called a bigot. And I interviewed Jamil Shaw Sr., the father of the young man who was murdered here in South Central Los Angeles, a young man who was bound to go to college and an illegal alien had just gotten out of prison, and assumed that the red that Jamil Shaw II was wearing was an indication of a gang membership, when in fact Shaw was not a member of a gang, and he got blown away. Donald Trump has brought out Jamil Shaw Sr. to talk about all of this and to humanize this. This is very important.
Sure. Well, Larry, I want to be clear. I mean, I think he has done well not apologizing. There's so many factoids, things you were mentioning, that, I mean, I guess if he had your brain on these issues, it'd be better. That's all I'm saying is that...
I wish I had his brain and his wealth.
No, I hear you, but you're an expert on this is what I'm saying. And then sure, he's not apologizing. That's 101, don't do that. I agree with you. He's doing a pretty good job. It's just that they're misrepresenting him, and I don't think he's been attacking them for their lies. He just kind of arrogantly, which I guess is a good thing, just ignores them and says, I don't apologize.
Well, that's true, but it's early. He'll get sharper. He'll get better. He'll get more factoids. He'll sharpen up his arguments along the way, assuming he stays in. And so far, it's been pretty darn impressive. I was one of those, Alex, who thought he was never going to get in. Every 4 years, he comes out, makes a big display about running, and then he doesn't run. And I also didn't think he had as much money as he says he has. Apparently, he does have $9 million. Apparently, he can self-fund. There's never been a candidate like this with this kind of message, this kind of name recognition, and that kind of bankroll. And so this could get very interesting.
So you think he's serious? Well, it does show the other, 10 or 11 candidates. Why aren't they getting hardcore on anchor babies? I mean, El Chapo, the billionaire drug dealer, is on record telling his wife to come up here and have anchor babies. We have to pay for billionaire drug dealers' kids now. I mean, this is ridiculous.
He's also on record threatening Donald Trump, for crying out loud. And this issue is a very important issue for people living in the inner city. And I think once more black people realize he's talking to them and talking about their economic interests, it'll be fascinating to see what kind of black support this Republican guy gets.
Well, I mean, I would certainly rather Donald Trump than a Hillary Clinton in there. But in your gut, and I really respect your opinion on this, you don't think he's some type of ringer just getting political attention for his overall empire?
Oh, I think it's all of the above. I think that Donald Trump feels the worst thing that'll happen is his name recognition will be even higher, and maybe he'll make even more money. But I don't think he anticipated the fallout. I don't think he anticipated that ESPN and NASCAR and Univision and NBC would dump him, and other people are also thinking about dumping him. He may even lose clients in his condos. Who knows? But I think overall what Donald Trump feels is the worst that'll happen is my brand will be even bigger, but maybe I'll make some noise. Maybe I'll make something happen. And let's not discount the possibility that he's sincere. He thinks the country's going to hell in a handbasket. He thinks our foreign policy is weak. He thinks our deals with the various other countries are weak. And he thinks the country's going down. And he thinks he, as a business person, can do something about it. I applaud the idea of him going off the grid for this time and spending his time and his energy and his money trying to make the country better as opposed to making more money. Why aren't people applauding that?
I guess I have to say I applaud him because he is getting persecuted now and he's not backing down and he's not going to do the Miss America thing. He's going to focus on the campaign. Again, though, Larry, doesn't this show the other Republicans what they should have been doing the whole time?
It most certainly does. The other Republicans are wusses, and that's one of the things that pisses people off. I mean, how did we get Obamacare shoved down our throats? How did that happen? Obamacare, unpopular, not a single Republican vote, and you guys couldn't figure out a way legislatively of stopping this thing?
Larry Elder, LarryElder.com, stay there. I want to come back and get your take on how do we reverse Obamacare? How do we control the border? How do we stop the hemorrhaging of our sovereignty straight ahead? And what is he most worried about with Obama in Obama's last year and a half? Final segment with Larry Elder, syndicated radio host, best-selling author. David Knight's got analysis on all of this that ties together with Dinesh D'Souza being ordered by a Democrat judge to attend psychiatric counseling for his mental illness. The judge is now diagnosing from the bench that he thinks the government's too big and bad. That's now a mental illness. That's right out of the Soviet Union. Right out of the Soviet Union. So that's coming up in a moment. Again, Larry Elder has been breaking down how we're having our basic rights being removed, but they're being replaced with infighting and obsessing over what color somebody is or where they're from. And then the sensitivity to it becomes just a ball and chain. But what I was getting at here is that what they do with political correctness on black and white relations or with the open borders or with kids can't call themselves boys or girls, but purple penguins because it's hurtful. We talk about this and it doesn't sound like reality. It sounds like mentally ill cult leaders run the country. And so if it's already gotten this bad and they want to kick Donald Trump off the air with his TV shows because he said we got a bunch of criminals coming up here to escape justice and they shouldn't be getting their babies paid for. I mean, nobody else allows this. And so it is a upside downing of reality. What comes next, Larry Elder? And how do we overturn this? How do we defeat this system when the public schools don't teach reading and writing anymore? They just teach bizarro basket casing of don't be a boy and girl. Boys are in the girls' bathroom. Girls are in the boys. You're a purple penguin. Let's learn about your white guilt all day on MTV. I mean, it's just crazy.
Donald Trump used the term silent majority. What people need to do is stand up and defend the values and the freedom that made this country great. We need more people like you speaking out. I mean, it is insane. And Donald Trump had the cashews to not once, not twice, but three times when he was in Phoenix call Al Sharpton a con man. Who has done that? What other public figure has honestly and accurately called Al Sharpton a con man other than Donald Trump? And Donald Trump gets dumped by NBC, but MSNBC, one of NBC's subsidiaries, has given Al Sharpton, perhaps the most notorious anti-Semitic race hustler in America, his nightly show for an hour. Scotty, beam me up. It's insane.
And you're quoting the late Congressman Jim Trafficant. I mean, it really is time to be beamed up, Scotty. I mean, this is, what do you expect next out of this lunacy?
Next thing, he's going to push for further gun control. Every time something happened, like what happened in Charleston, South Carolina, Obama talks about more gun control. Now, Dylann Roof did not stand up there after communing with these nine innocent worshipers and pull out a Confederate flag and shoot people. He pulled out a .38. We ought to be talking about whether or not somebody in that church with a concealed carry permit might have minimized the damage. We ought to be talking about what's going on in Chicago, sure, and Washington, D.C., two cities with very stringent gun control laws, very high per capita murder rate. Most of the people being killed are black people. We're not talking about that, though. We're talking about the Confederate flag and Donald Trump. It is crazy.
Well, look, I don't want to pull a Han Solo here on folks, Larry Elder, but if I was a senator, especially a black senator in the South where there are some crazy racist white people, and I'm going to be given a sermon, there's going to be one of these up underneath the pulpit, 357 Magnum. It's only six shots, but I'm a good aim with it, and I'll be able to defend myself. I mean, in this day and age, we know more guns mean less crime. We know these killers, whether they be on drugs or be racist or whatever, only hit people they think are going to be disarmed. Isn't it time to start making areas hard targets? I mean, when ISIS tried to attack in Garland outside Dallas, it was an off-duty cop took those guys out before they could kill anybody. I mean, isn't that the answer, that he pulls that gun out and somebody pulls a gun out and blows him away and maybe only two people would have been dead, him and maybe the first person he shot? I mean, isn't that the answer? Isn't it gun-free zones and an anti-gun culture really what ended up killing these people?
That is the answer, or at least that even the odds a little bit for the good guys. There are now 40 states that allow citizens to carry concealed weapons on a shell issue basis. And if it returns us to the so-called Wild Wild West, why hasn't at least one of those states repealed it? They haven't. And speaking of racism, obviously this guy was a racist, but to act like he's some sort of tip of the spear, back in 1969, another white guy named Charlie Manson wanted to start a race war, and he had a family. And he got seven white people killed over two nights. We didn't talk about how much racism there is in America. We said Charlie Manson is a racist nutcase, and so is this guy. So let's not act as if some sort of movement on the part of white people to mow down black people. This is a deviant individual who acted in an evil, vicious way, and we ought not assume that, therefore, this reflects the racism in America's DNA, and therefore shows that we're not, quote, cured of racism. We're never going to be cured of racism. 10% of the American people, Alex, believe Elvis is still alive. 8% believe if you send him a letter, he's going to get it. That's a lot of people in America, but you can't act, you can't look for Nirvana. We're never going to have Nirvana.
Well, I mean, he also, this roof guy liked to wear black outfits. Does that mean anybody that's into wearing black, like Johnny Cash, is a racist? I mean, it's just crazy.
He also had a gold T-shirt on, and he also had the flags of Rhodesia and South Africa. Should we ban those as well? For crying out loud, it wasn't the Confederate flag that made him do what he did. He's an evil degenerate and should be regarded as such, the same way we regarded Charlie Manson.
Well, notice both of them were on hard drugs.
Both of them were on hard drugs. Both of them wanted to start a race war. And both of them thought by doing this, they would start one. They were both crazy. They're both insane. We assumed Manson was insane and a deviant, but we're acting like Dylann Roof represents some sort of a movement in America, when in fact he doesn't.
Sure. In fact, can we put Dylann Roof and Charlie Manson, pictures of them up on screen as soon as you can? You look at both of them, they have that crazy look in their eye.
They sure do.
And again,
in 69, we said Charlie Manson was a hateful deviant. Why aren't we saying the same thing about Dylann Roof all these years later, after we've had the election of a black president and the re-election of a black president?
I mean, I look at Charlie Manson and I just see, I mean, look at them. They've got the same crazy look in their eye. And
That's
they
right.
were both on hard drugs.
And in Manson's case, he at least had a following. Dylann Roof, in his racist manifesto, complained that he couldn't even get anybody to follow him. He said the Klan wouldn't even follow him. That's the extent to which racism has reduced as a problem here in America.
And let's just say it, the Democrats that were the party of the Klan are very upset that their race politics might be in trouble, so they're trying to reignite it. And Larry, in closing, I want you to comment on this and whatever else is on your radar, because I've been asking the questions. But my concern is, you see the knockout game, and those are isolated, but it is happening a lot around the country. You do see racial attacks against whites, and the people doing it really think they're doing a good job because the media has told them, you know, all white people hate you, and they're the reason you're unemployed, and they got a bunch of young kids, hoodlums. I mean, if you see them, the same folks that are robbing people in their own neighborhood out doing this, and when it happens, the media is even scared to admit it's a racial attack by racist blacks against whites because MSNBC and other con men like Al Sharpton have legitimized it. So if whites are going to be collectively blamed, which we know is a fraud for bad white people doing stuff, then what about this push by the New Black Panthers and others to say, hey, don't mug and thug in your own neighborhood. Go do it to whitey. I'm really concerned with this new thing, pull down Confederate flags out of people's backyards. I'm afraid there's going to be a flashpoint here, and that the Democratic Party really is playing with fire. And I think they're trying to start a civil war. And that's what George Soros does in other countries. And George Soros is funding all the anti-cop stuff. What do you think's going on?
Well, facts don't matter. The fact is that over the last 30 or 40 years, police shootings against blacks are down about 75%. Police shootings against whites have flatlined. And in 2012, the last year the CDC has numbers, about 140 blacks were killed by cops. Over 2.5 times that many whites were killed by cops. The fact is that there's a study that came out at University of Washington. Black and white cops are more reluctant to pull the trigger against a black suspect than a white suspect, probably because they feel there's going to be a raft of grief. And over the last 10 years, about 1,000 blacks have been killed by cops. About 2,000 whites have been killed by cops. Last year, 6,000 black people were killed, mostly by other black people. Chicago alone, about 40 per month. Most of those are unsolved. Most of those are by and against other black people. And you mentioned violent interracial crime. There's about 500,000 to 750,000 violent interracial acts of crime, black, white, every year. That's murder, attempted murder, manslaughter, rape, assault with a deadly weapon. 75% are black perpetrator and white victim, only 15% the other way around.
And I think, because I've read the police reports, I've seen the news articles, the people say, I did it, like that guy up in Michigan, because they were white. They somehow think, like the Klan goes out and kills some black person and hangs them because they deserve it. It literally is like Klan ideology the Democrats are trying to project onto black people. It's sick.
Well, that's what they're trying to do. As I mentioned before, the Democratic Party has to make black people feel like victims. Otherwise, how do you justify going in that voting booth and pulling that lever 95% for one particular party? You have to malign the Republican Party, have to call the Republican Party racist, have to say that they're trying to, as Debbie Wasserman Schultz once said, roll back the clock to Jim Crow and convince black people that the man's out to get you. Otherwise, you can't scare people into voting 95% for one party. Let's not talk about the facts. Let's not talk about the family. Let's not talk about what Obama's done to the black middle class. Let's talk about racism and social justice. That's what they're all about, because they can't talk about economic growth because they have no story.
Well, it's really sad, because up until Obama got elected, I saw a lot of racial harmony, people coming together. It was just really refreshing. And now I've never seen it so energized in my whole life, not growing up in the, you know, early 70s and stuff in the 80s. And it just is, it's so cold-blooded. And I can just see the Democratic Party spin doctors, the PR firms in their meetings going, we've doubled unemployment, people are waking up, they're upset, we're not delivering, just create balkanization. It's how the British controlled India with just a few thousand troops, was playing different religious groups off against each other, and they've just cold-bloodedly done this to us, Larry, and I'm really concerned now that they're going to put Hillary in, and it's going to be not, oh, you're racist if you don't want Obamacare, it's going to be, You're sexist if you don't support whatever she's doing. And, you know, it's just so insulting that I would love to have a female president if she agreed with basic freedom. I don't care if it's a woman or a man. You know, I like a lot of the stuff Margaret Thatcher did. It's so insulting to be told I don't like Obama because he's part African, or that I don't like Hillary because she's a woman. I don't like Hillary because she's an absolute criminal monster.
It is insulting. But I got to tell you, I once interviewed Kwesi Mfume, one of the few so-called black leaders I was able to get on my program. And I said, Mr. Mfume, as between the presence of white racism or the absence of black fathers, which poses a bigger threat to the black community? And to his credit, without missing a beat, Alex, he said, the absence of black fathers. So some people are getting it. And I noticed that young blacks are far more less likely than older blacks to self-identify as Democrats. They're not identifying as Republicans, but they're identifying as independents, because they see what's happening to their economic future. They have no job. The black teenage unemployment is up, and people coming out of college can't get work. And they're saddled with a lot of debt.
That's right.
So a lot of young people are beginning to rethink their assumptions. And so that's probably the only silver lining I can think of to 8 years of President Obama.
And if the Republicans would line up with a more libertarian mindset and would promote things, then they would support him. But the Republicans are so bad in the leadership that I get why young people don't want to be involved with them as well. Larry Elder, thank you so much for the time. LarryElder.com. Folks can find your books, your essays, your radio and TV shows. Congratulations on the success in the last 20 years of your work. It's just great to have you out there.
Thank you so much for having me, Alex. I appreciate it.
You bet. Great to have Larry Elder on with us. Okay, in the Situation Room is David Knight. We're going to go to him here in just a moment. Briefly, we have free shipping in the month of July on all products that ship out of our warehouse. And that's basically 99% of the stuff that's in there. There's a few items like storable food and things like that that go from the warehouse of the producers, My Patriot Supply. We have their entire spectrum of My Patriot Supply products at the same price they sell them. It just supports this broadcast when you buy it from us at InfoWarsStore.com. But you won't get the free shipping. That's just an example. But everything else that we sell, shortwave radios, non-GMO seeds, super high-quality nutraceuticals, books, videos, it's all free shipping right now. 25% off on the Molon Labe belt buckles. Those will be sold out soon, so that special will have to end. 10% off all the T-shirts. And there's just a bunch of other specials in the month of July celebrating our independence at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. And we did sell out of Prostaguard for 2.5 months. It's back in, and I guess I screwed up again and didn't order a bigger order. They did the first original order again, so that will probably sell out in a few weeks. It did last time. The best prostate formula out there, but has so many other great effects. Just read more at InfoWarsLife.com. And we will sell out of the best Nation Iodine purest form out there, X2, in the next week. It will sell out, and it'll be at least 2-3 weeks till we get more, and that's if we're able to secure it. We're trying right now, although in the next few days. But to be sure you get it, Survival Shield X2 is selling out. Super Male and Super Female Vitality will sell out in the next week and a half. That's a conservative estimate, but those will be back in within a month, so that'll just be sold out for 2 weeks. Brainforce should be back in about 3 weeks, but we're not going to start pre-order until next week to make sure after it's already manufactured, then it's got to be tested 3 times. And so that's what I'm not complaining. It's just to have the highest quality and not cut corners. It's hard. And then sometimes we just can't get an ingredient anymore. And we have to change the formulation. I mean, we just go through a lot of stuff here, but it's the highest quality. InfoWarsLife.com. And you have my pledge to not compromise, to promote human liberty with your support. Please keep spreading the word about the broadcast as well. You can also call toll free 888-253-3139. Now joining us, from the InfoWars.com Situation Room, the former radio studio that we've had here for 8 years in these offices, is David Knight. More and more, we're just going to have our reporters from locations in Europe, locations in California, locations from studios in this building, just break in. And I've told them, I want this to be live, powerful, real. When they get something interesting, something breaking, an analysis, just let me know 10 minutes before. In this case, it was an hour before. And we'll just have them go in the other studio. I'll break into a guest or come in after a break with a minute of information, 5 minutes of information, 10 minutes of information to keep you up to date on the latest. So David Knight joins us from the Situation Room. I'm here in the War Room at InfoWars headquarters. David Knight.
Alex, I wanted to talk about what's going on with Dinesh D'Souza. And of course, you've mentioned this earlier. We have the article up on InfoWars.com from WND, Jerome Corsi. The fact that this is raw political persecution, like we've seen before in the Soviet Union or East Germany, this is a Democratic judge ordering psychological counseling for Dinesh D'Souza and an additional to continue his community service for another 4 years. Now,
and by the way, that's super expensive.
Yes, yes. And this is a situation, Alex, where the judge has overruled the recommendations of 2 licensed psychological counselors.
Okay, and this is Reagan's former top speechwriter and a member of the administration and one of the most successful documentary filmmakers of all time.
Exactly, because he's a threat to this kind of mindless witch hunts that we see coming on right now throughout everything that touches on the South. I mean, Alex, we've even had Atticus Finch now being reinvented as a Ku Klux Klan racist, the guy who was in To Kill a Mockingbird.
They're Atticus that goes that up against the racist.
Yes.
And everybody, he's now a racist? I didn't know that.
He's now a racist. That's the book that is now being released. Of course, the original author, Harper Lee, is now 89 years old. Her lawyer claims that she found a manuscript. A lot of people said it looks like fan fiction, so I don't know if this is authentic or not, or if this is just an effort to make a quick buck and to tap into the zeitgeist of the culture right now to go after.
Yeah, this is a race-baiting orgy.
Yes, exactly. It's absolutely insane. And of course, we cannot have any white men who are role models, especially if they're Southern. We have to.
That's why he has to be gotten rid of. But this is racism against Southerners.
And listen to what the judge said, too, Alex. He says, I'm not singling out Mr. D'Souza to pick on him. A requirement for psychological counseling often comes up in my hearings in cases where I find it hard to understand why someone did what they did. What did he do? He didn't fill out some paperwork. There wasn't any criminal intent. There wasn't anything psychological about donating money to somebody's campaign.
He formed a PAC that raised $30,000 and didn't fill out the right paperwork,
exactly.
Just like the Texas Attorney General, who's now about to be indicted.
So they nail him on a technicality. And then what they do is they try to pretend that he is psychologically disturbed somehow so they can keep their hooks into him for a long time. This is raw political manipulation, going after their political opponents, creating a crime where there is none. And yet, look at what happened in this article I talked about last Friday when I was on the radio about Eric Holder. As Matt Taibbi with Rolling Stones pointed out, he never sent anyone to jail for financial crimes, and yet we had large banks that were manipulating the LIBOR exchange. They were laundering money for drug cartels and terrorists. El Chapo, that's everybody is talking about, who just escaped from prison, he was head of the Sinaloa cartel. And they were making videos of them chopping people's heads off with chainsaws, and yet Eric Holder couldn't find anything to send this guy to jail for. Couldn't find anything to send the HSBC people who were laundering money for him. They even gave the Sinaloa cartel, El Chapo, their own private window to do cash deposits and withdrawals. That's how criminal this organization is. And Obama said, some of the most damaging behavior on Wall Street, in some cases, some of the least ethical behavior on Wall Street wasn't illegal. In other words, they try to make every excuse they can. And Matt Taibbi pointed out, he said, yes, some of it wasn't illegal, but a huge amount of it
was. Here's the deal. Wachovia and Wells Fargo got caught running the drug aircraft and owning them and leasing them. And Holder now sits over the big Wall Street firm that if they certify what your bank or group is doing, never gets overturned by the Justice Department because it's the payoff door where they go in and out.
Yes, absolutely.
And of course, that's the headline. Eric Holder comes in out of the cold back into Wall Street. We can put that back up on screen. Powerful photo of him walking off Air Force One for the last time. Why Eric Holder's new job is an insult to the American public. Even Salon, that's connected to the White House, I don't know what they're doing telling the truth, says it's a bad thing. I mean, this is so naked that Dinesh D'Souza, no criminal record, didn't even have speeding tickets.
You know, you really nailed it, Alex, a year ago when you did the interviews with Dinesh D'Souza, one of the videos that you put up. This is the title, Dinesh D'Souza Sentenced to Brainwashing Camp. That's precisely what this is. This is so over the top. And yet, you've got Eric Holder, who made $2.5 million from this law firm representing the big banks that he refused to prosecute. They even kept his office vacant for him, Alex. He never really left their employ, did he?
Well, that's right. And to be clear, the reason I said that a year ago on July 14th, yesterday was the 14th. The reason I said that a year ago was because in the prison he was in, minimum security facility that he was in, it was basically just all psychological counseling all day long. Imagine 9 months in there being basically brainwashed.
Yeah, exactly. And now they're going to continue that even over the recommendations of professional counselors. Like I said, if they want to go after somebody, you know, we see this kind of like the French Revolution, the way they're going after every single vestige of symbolism, after they're going after every cultural icon. Of course, Disney for the longest time did not allow Song of the South to be sold. They said it looked like it was racist because it was about a former slave. Look, Aesop's fables were written by a former slave. The real story here is that a slave like Aesop's, a slave like Uncle Remus, and of course Uncle Remus wasn't a real person, it was a collection of multiple older slaves that this man had met on plantations when he worked on the plantations himself. He put together the stories, he told what their names were, and he told their stories.
That's a story that should be celebrated.
Exactly.
It's empowering, and they want it banned. That's what's so crazy, is that they want to be able to take down even good things because they know if they can do that, they can ban anything they want, any time they want.
And that's what we're seeing right now. They're flushing African-American culture down the memory hole just like they are all Southern culture. And yet the real story here, Alex, as you point out, is a slave who transcends his masters. We don't know who the masters
were. Maybe we should ban the movie Spartacus because it's about a slave.
Exactly. And yet we have the Southern Poverty Law Center. Morris Deese, the founder of them, actually worked for George Wallace in the rabid segregation days. He actually defended the Klan, who were burning buses of protesters, who were beating protesters. He made enough profit off of that it was equivalent to what the median family income of four was in those days. And then Morris Deese, founder of the Southern Poverty Law Center, sat out the entire civil rights movement. About a decade later, he was brought back in because he had become a mass marketing, direct marketer expert. They brought him in for the McGovern campaign. Then he took that list of people that he got from McGovern and started the Southern Poverty Law Center. If you want to get somebody who's connected to the Klan, if you want to get somebody who is rabidly racist, it's Morris Deese. It's not Atticus Finch.
And that's what's crazy is that the Democratic Party was racist, was the founder of the Klan. They couldn't beat Republicans because all these vets were coming back in the South and refusing to be part of the oppression that was indeed happening in some areas, like my dad's dad. He flipped being a Republican, ran for county government one. The family wasn't upset with him, but he was the first person, you know, because, I mean, Texas was Democrat, to do that. But that was everywhere. They came back and they said, we're ending this. This is over. And Eisenhower led that movement. The Republicans led that movement. And then they flip it and turn around and say that the NRA is the Klan. Again, it's an inversion of reality, David.
Well, the troubling thing, too, Alex, is that, of course, the SPLC has been doing this. The Southern Poverty Law Center has been doing this for a very long time, flipping reality. But now we see this going viral, going across the entire country. It's like watching the 2 minutes of hate from 1984, where everybody just screams at Goldstein because they have to have an enemy. And that's what this is. This is an irrational purging. It's an ethnic cleansing.
Yeah, don't be mad at the foreign bankers looting you. Don't be mad at the fluoride in the water. Don't be mad at all the stuff happening to us. Just scream and yell and hyperventilate if you see a rebel flag, and next it's a brown bag. Stay with us. We got Tosh Plumlee coming up, too. CIA whistleblower. Hey, be mad about the government. David Knight, I noticed there in the studio you've got a stack of other items you wanted to mention. We got Tosh Plumlee joining us in the next segment with more info on Benghazi. But first, get into those other points from the Situation Room.
Well, Alex, you know, when we're talking about the coming after cultural icons, even like Song of the South, like To Kill a Mockingbird, those were works of fiction that were essentially uniting fiction. I mean, they were uplifting. They brought black and white together. They treated people as human. I mean, they talk about Atticus Finch. Many people said, well, you know, he was paternalistic. He was some kind of a white messiah. Look,
no, that's why it's bad, because he takes care of his kids. You don't know what happened to his wife.
That's right.
He's a strong guy that does the right thing. And there was lots of people like that. That's based on real type characters.
Yes.
And he's a good lawyer. So they can't even allow that now.
And let me tell you, if you get in trouble, you want a lawyer like Atticus Finch. You want somebody who's going to be a messiah figure, who is going to go to bat to you no matter the kinds of pressure that he has to sell you down the river. So he's become something of a patron saint to a lot of lawyers as well as to the general population. But Alex, when we look at the way they're coming after people selectively, going after Dinesh D'Souza in this virulent way, and yet letting major crimes go unpunished, nobody got any personal fines at any of these major banks. Nobody did any jail time at any of these major banks. They were laundering billions of dollars
and
for drug cartels.
And now he goes to work for the big bank lobbying firm.
Yes.
That's the former attorney general who got caught running the false flag of Fast and Furious. It really is insane.
But when you go back and look at this, and Rob Dew has a news break where he's talking about the new law that took effect yesterday in Spain, massive censorship of freedom of speech. And here's one of the things. Be careful with royal jokes. They say any satirical comment against the Spanish royal family is now a crime against the crown. We're headed back into a medieval kind of authoritarian rule, and that's precisely why Dinesh D'Souza is there. They don't call it that, but if you're going to send somebody do hard time because they didn't fill out some paperwork properly, there wasn't anything criminal, there wasn't anything insane about what he did, unless, of course, like the old joke in the Soviet Union, they put you in insane asylums if you go against the government, because, of course, you are insane if you criticize the government. That's the kind of government we have now in the Obama administration. Blatant, in-your-face criminal actions where they go after massive political movements, just like they went after the Tea Party people using the IRS. Nixon was impeached for that when he did it to a few of his political enemies, just a couple of the close-knit people that were in the Democrat Party when they burglarized their office. Now everybody is being burglarized by the NSA. Everybody is being targeted by the IRS, and nothing happens.
Evil has basically burrowed out the bottom. The bottom's now fallen out. The sky's the limit. Yeah. I was reading that article on Infowars.com this morning, 10 things that show there's a major police state. I don't have it in front of me, but I think that was the headline. And it's just incredible. You can't even criticize the government or the police. Spanish are famous for having outdoor parties and meeting together in the town squares. That's banned.
Well, Alex, you can get a 30,000 euro dollar you can get 30,000 euro fine if you take pictures of security personnel and put it on a social media page. That's how draconian these laws are. 30,000 euro fine for taking pictures of security personnel.
And that's because Spain is going into full financial collapse under the EU dictatorship.
Yes.
And they know that they've got 40% unemployment. I mean, it's just amazing.
And then at the same time, you've got David Cameron in the UK saying we need to outlaw encryption. It's being repeated by the current FBI director, because we're all going into economic hard times and we're all going to get the jackboot in the face to keep us under control.
That's right. It's just mind-blowing to realize they're getting ready for a global depression. They're preparing the population for the screws to be put into us. It's unprecedented. Jade Helm starts tomorrow. We're going to be covering that big time. Those of us that know about globalism, the New World Order, how the world really works, we tend to then just get conditioned to accept this stuff going on around us because we already know about it, as if knowing about it gives us power over it. No, we have to know about it. Go ahead and bring it in, Leanne. Thanks. We have to know about it. Come on up here with me. We have to know about it. She's going to be hosting the show, by the way, the first 20 minutes or 30 minutes of the next hour in overdrive. Thank you, Leanne. We get to the point of just not being shocked anymore when now in multiple European countries, they are making employees at companies get implantable microchips as a condition of working at the companies. Or it's in the news yesterday and today, major governments, including the EU, admitting that Gardasil is killing and hurting people, the HPV shot. And, of course, we knew that 10 years ago, so why should we talk about it now? Because folks are now ready to listen. And I knew about this yesterday, didn't cover it, and I didn't cover it today. And when Leanne walked in during the last break and said, why aren't you covering this? She goes, I'm happy to come on because I want to get her and others used to being on live because they're really smart folks. Why not? Why do you want me to cover parallel construction that we had with the IRS agent, a Treasury agent discussion, where they frame people and train folks how to frame people? That was an interview on the Nightly News last night. We're going to re-air it in overdrive. Then Leanne and Jakari were going to comment. She goes, I'd like to talk about, or you should talk about, Planned Parenthood. She's like, I didn't know they were selling body parts of babies. And she like had tears in her eyes, which is a normal human response. And then I got a sinking feeling because I have that blind spot that I've been talking for 20 years about how they sell the baby parts. These women go in these abortuaries and they pay $300 on average. And it's been the same price since, you know, I was 18 years old to get an abortion. I know because I had a girlfriend. I didn't want her to have the abortion. She didn't tell me. She didn't tell me she was pregnant. And afterwards, she told me. She said, but don't worry, it was only $300 and my mom paid. And then I learned about the price in the last few years. It's still $300. And regardless of what you say about abortion, it's a dehumanizing act. And the reason they don't want to end third trimester partial birth, even though the babies could be just cesarean and saved and sold for hundreds of thousands to adopters, they can get more for their hearts and lungs and livers. Because you can put them into children and then they'll rapidly grow. And these women could be, if there was a market in this where you grow a baby up to 9 months, kill it the day before it's delivered, you could get $200,000 conservatively for the heart, the liver, the lungs, the kidneys. I mean, one kidney could be 50 grand. There's two kidneys, a liver, the heart, you get 50, 60 grand for a heart. You get 100 grand for a liver. We're talking 300, 400, 500 grand. But let's just say 200 grand for you, 200 grand for the abortuary, 100 grand for the broker. Women that are into abortion, in fact, these pro-abortion folks that tell us they're Satanists and they love the devil, we have it on video, and that they love killing babies. Well, you, why'd you pay 300? I mean, you could have got hundreds of thousands. So create a market in it. And I'm being cynical right now because it hurts my heart to talk about it. So being cynical and sick with satire is a way to kind of have gallows humor here. But here's the headline, and she's going to play the video with Jakari, some clips of it, after we play that other report. And they're welcome to the whole next hour if they want. Some stations still carry the fourth hour. I quit doing it for a few years, but it's still there. We go into overdrive sometimes. We're going to bring the whole fourth hour back, but it's going to be a news blitz, fast-paced analysis, magazine shows type fourth hour, where I'm there most of the time, but some of the time I'm not. It's just too valuable an hour. The stations want it. We're going to do it. The time's special. I'm going to Tosh Plumlee. It's just that she walked in totally freaked out going, there's video. It's in mainstream news. They admit it. What? They sell the baby parts with tears in her eyes. That's a normal response. Yes, that's why they like to get them as in one piece. And then the truth is some of these facilities keep them alive on a respirator while they chop them up. Because it takes a while to gut one and to not... See, you don't want to hurt the arteries. You got to cut them just right for the surgeons. All the organs have got to be prepared just right. It has to be done lovingly, delicately. And if you were wearing a black-tipped hat and had green skin, it would be the most horrifying movie ever. It wouldn't be a funny witch anymore where they're flying monkeys going, I'll get you, if she was slicing open the baby. But because it's all cute and funny and a doctor does it, it's nice. But this has been known forever. This has been known forever. And it's just now come out. But this is what they do. Now, I apologize to Tosh for talking over him. I appreciate him coming on. Tosh Plumlee is undoubtedly, other than Daniel Ellsberg and the Pentagon Papers or somebody like Snowden, the biggest whistleblower in modern history. He blew the whistle in the 60s. He blew it in the 70s. He blew it in the 80s. He's one of the top people in the church hearings in Iran-Contra. And because he blew the whistle on criminal activity, he didn't lose his job. He still was a contractor and is still a contractor flying C-130s. He supplied Fidel Castro when he was still CIA. And he's been death threatened. He's been subpoenaed. He's been harassed. He's been everything to bring you the information, and he's got more. But he is irritated that stuff that's now come out in Congress and come out on Fox News, though a bit whitewashed, was said here in 2013 and in 2014. Colonel Schaefer also said similar things and got in a lot of trouble. So it's important to remember what these men went through to expose what Benghazi really was. Believe me, when he's on, the government's listening. But he has a lot of supporters in the government as well. The government's made up of good and bad people. That's why all that evil men and tyrants need to flourish is that good men and women do nothing, as many of our founding fathers said in different ways. So I want to play a couple-minute clip of Tosh breaking down the Benghazi info years ago here that's now household information. Then we'll get the latest from Tosh Plumlee. Here it is. Again, in your own words, what happened at Benghazi? Because my intel is, from multiple sources, they killed the ambassador and his crew because they were saying no to giving missiles to Al-Qaeda.
They were not only saying no to giving missiles to Al-Qaeda. That was the second deal. We were giving high-impact weapons to the Syrian rebels. Within that group was some of the Al-Qaeda members and so on like that, which pilfered those weapons and used them against our people. The story about someone doing a film that made the people go radical and go crazy over there was a cover story to cover a top-secret ongoing operation of arms shipments to the Syrian rebels, period, before our president, commander-in-chief, decided that we needed to arm the Syrians. I am not a conspiracy person. This information that I got comes from multiple sources. In other words, it was a very serious situation that was rapidly developing over there. In other words, the State Department and other agencies refused or did not get back to them in time because they were concerned of how that was going to look politically. It would be a political bombshell if it was revealed that U.S. weapons at that point in time were being given to factions in the Middle East, through Turkey, Jordan. It would also expose methods and procedures. It would also expose our CIA safe houses that were operating in Jordan and other places, Pakistan and Turkey, and Saudi Arabia. It would expose those operations that were involved. It would expose our politicians on both sides of the aisle that was involved in corporate gain.
The information that I had about missiles going to the wrong places came 2 years ago. It was, I think, even talked about on your show, Alex.
Yeah, it was talked about here first with you, yes.
Yes, right. And at that point, I started getting a little heat. Politicians did not, some people did not want to hear this. It was not with the administration. It was not the policy of the administration at that point in time. The CIA's Forrest Gump was talking again about things he knew absolutely nothing about. Well, about a year later, it was confirmed. Another thing that was confirmed around that time was the training bases that was inside Jordan and was also safe houses in Turkey and Jordan, where U.S. weapons and also Russian weapons were being stored in these safe houses. And they were also had training sites at various places located in Syria, Jordan, and Turkey. Now, where did that information come from? That information didn't come from our intelligence. It came from NATO intelligence and other sources, including the French.
All right, that's Tosh Plumlee. We're going to skip this network break because this is so important, but no other breaks can be skipped so that he gets more time. That was 2.5 years ago and then a year ago. Now all of this is starting to come out, and Tosh is irritated that Fox News, others ignored what he was saying when it first came out. Now they're covering it, and now we know Hillary was taking money from these foreign governments at this very time to her Clinton Foundation when she headed up the State Department and allowed all this to happen. So unbelievable criminal activity, extremely naked. Tosh, thank you for your courage. Thank you for coming on. I know you've had disinformation campaigns launched against you, a lot of harassment, Justice Department threats since you've been on. We've had a lot of escalation as well for covering this issue. But the good news is the info's out. So go ahead. Don't pause. You've got the floor.
Well, okay, Alex, let me clear up a couple of things. I am totally retired now, not indebted to any kind of government agency or something like that.
So that was just the last year or so then?
Yeah, right, just the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And then I sort of got back involved through friends, through associates that knew that these things were going on, illegal acts. Some of them were getting tired of being labeled that these were intelligence failures, that was bringing these things to light. They were not intelligence failures. They were totally political failures. A lot of us pilots, a lot of us ops on the ground, we stay in touch with each other. A couple of my friends got transferred over to, they are still military active, got transferred over to NATO intelligence. And then that's how I sort of got back involved in this. And become an investigative reporter, if that's what you want to call it. So at the time, 2 years ago, when we were talking about this, these were allegations. And these were mostly labeled by this administration and the State Department as being conspiracy-oriented, politically out to grind someone down or something like that. That was not the case. So what I started doing was, as you know, started pulling all this information together that gets buried by mainstream media, scattered out there to where the average person cannot even find it, even if they're looking for it or they know where to go to find it. So I started Facebook, using that Facebook as a tool, not as a gossip rag, but as a tool to bring all this information together about Benghazi and other illegal activities in reference to international gun running that was going on within our government. There are some damn good people inside our government, as you mentioned earlier, and then also there's some very bad eggs. So I've been privileged, if that's the right word to use, to watch this thing unfold for over 40 years. I've been in and out of ops. I've been chastised. I've been shot at. I've been, anyway, but it's not about me. It's about the operations. The operations that we get involved with, the operations of how they become infiltrated by political interest, how we are not allowed to do our particular jobs in upholding the Constitution and protecting this nation because of infiltration with political agendas. So I don't want to ramble and all that kind of stuff. The reason
you're not rambling, I mean, break it down.
The reason I got back in sort of touch and got back involved on this and trying to stay focused on the Benghazi thing, there's so much corruption going on out there within this government, within this administration, within the State Department, within the DOJ, so much corruption based on political interest that it's appalling to me. And I believe as an American citizen, it's my responsibility, and also as a past military CIA operative, dating all the way back to the Cuban era, all the way up to now, taking the shots, taking the hits, taking the discrediting, taking all the other stuff. I believe it is my responsibility to say, okay, talk about what you know and bring it all together into one place and let's get it out there. So anyway, that's where I focused back on Benghazi. 2 years ago, this information was available to mainstream media. Mainstream media is totally controlled by the man, if you want to call it the man, by our political interests. We do not have investigative reporters. We have a few that work the beats, but they are controlled by political interests and also senior editors, and they cannot get their particular stories forward. That's the same case in this deal with Benghazi. Good investigative reporters have this story. They have had this story for years, but they're blocked because of State Department, because of stonewalling, because they can't get their information, even though it's highly vetted from many, many different creditable sources. They can't get it past the gatekeepers that are now in mainstream media. And I'm talking about all the major networks and all that. So now, the good thing about the internet is that now we and those people that really want, whistleblowers, I'm not crazy about that term, truth people, trying to get their stories out. The only place that they can get them out is on programs like yours, Alex, and other programs, Hagman and Hagman, and I won't name them all, but there's a bunch of them, Coast to Coast. Anyway, and I've been on all of them, but I've been consistent in what I'm saying. In other words, we have a government now that is a we and they. We have an environment in this country that is now a we and they situation. We have been desensitized to where we accept whatever they tell us. They manipulate the news media. They manipulate the reports. And I don't want to get on a soapbox and start ranting and off on all this kind of stuff. These are established facts. Anybody can check them out. Now, the reason that I've zeroed in and tried to stay focused on Benghazi is because on your program, you're the first person on the program, you and Coast to Coast, were the first persons that actually took this broadcast of where we went out and we said exactly what was going on. We named Stinger missiles missing. We named the annex. We named weapons coming off Gaddafi stockpiles in Libya being transferred into radical groups. We made statements that this administration knew about it. The U.S. State Department knew about it. The CIA knew about it. The military intelligence operatives out of the Pentagon, they knew about it. That does not mean that these people condoned it. They knew about it, but their hands were tied. In some cases, pensions were involved, IRS jumping all over.
And so we are the only ones crazy enough to put out the truth, so they used us, you, through these conduits, to tell the truth because they were so disgusted.
Well, that's what happened with me in Mexico when a friend of mine, Narco News, covered it. I was contacted by a task force that was working inside Mexico telling me that I would not believe what was going on in Mexico as far as weapon shipments going into the Mexican army and be filtrated into my buddy Joaquin Guzman, El Chapo, Carl Quintero, and all this kind of stuff. In other words, all I witnessed was a dog and pony show that came out of the State Department and the U.S. government.
You know, I should have mentioned that. We'll get back into Benghazi, but promise me you'll talk about El Chapo because, as you just said, you know him.
I know, I can tell you a lot of funny stories about that.
Oh, I know. This is very dangerous information. You haven't told a lot of it. You better just say it all. I don't want them coming after us. But listen, let's just get into all this now. Let's go ahead and get into the... You were upset about the fact that they're now covering some of Benghazi, but not all of it. Get into it.
Well, okay. The Benghazi thing came to me from a NATO source that had worked the Mexico beat back in 2009, 2008, 2009, and 2010, the House of Death and the old Fast and Furious program. They also got shoved under the rug. So those sources eventually went to drone school up in Nevada and then got transferred over to a NATO outfit over in Europe. As a result of that, some of the C-130 pilots that I didn't fly these runs, I'd flown earlier runs for the government. But in this particular case, I was more of an investigative reporter, or at least that's what I was passing myself off as. And they were, in turn, passing this information back to me. They were flabbergasted about how openly this information was going, about refueling C-130s packed with arms and ammunition going to the Middle East.
And as you said, it was the State Department with its export power that was giving the cover and the authorization for things that were clearly illegal. And now we know Hillary was being paid by foreign governments directly for it. This is pure espionage.
Well, exactly. And you covered it on your program, Alex, where I looked straight in the camera like I'm looking right now and told you this. Then it comes out, I'm going to get subpoenaed. And so I said one statement to them back then, and I think it was Grassley or Gowdy. I can't remember. I mean, to me, they're all the same. But, and I don't mean that negative or derogatory.
Well, Senator Grassley.
But whoever, you know, whatever they are. anyway, so I was contacted, had this information, put it out there that the biggest thing was Ambassador Stevens found out about the missing Stinger missiles. You have a clip there about McCain saying that all the pigs fly and all that.
Tell you what, stay there. We got to go to break. Our guest, Tosh Plumlee, is with us. We'll also try to give you some of the internet sites that have his information mirrored so you can check it out for yourself. But he's going to get into more on Benghazi and then El Chapo, that we talked about on this broadcast 2+ years ago. And now El Chapo has escaped from prison. Stay with us. Coming up in the fourth hour of Overdrive, we're bringing back the fourth hour on satellite for the stations for everybody. We're going to have Leanne McAdoo and Ja'Kari Jackson. They're going to air a special report from last night's Nightly News with a former Treasury agent, whistleblower, dealing with the fact that there is parallel construction in all the federal agencies to frame people, to create fake cases, and then put innocent people in prison. That's been confirmed with the DEA. They're still doing it. So there is a mainlining of corruption now that is just unprecedented, to where the government is beginning to go pure evil. And a lot of good people in government are blowing the whistle. This is not an us against government thing, but it is true that government is the big hammer through which these mafias are able to do this. Tosh Plumlee is our guest. Survival Shield X2, the best nascent iodine out there that fills up the thyroid and other glands with the good halogens, so the fluoride, the chlorine, the bromide, the bromine can't get in there. My energies increase, health, skin health, memory, stamina, weight loss is what I've personally experienced. Read the hundreds of reviews that we have linked on the site to third-party big review sites, and hear and read the rave reviews for yourself and see the facts, the studies at InfoWarsLife.com. You can also, again, order that and get free shipping for the month of July. It will sell out in the next week, and then we'll be out of it for at least 2 to 3 weeks, maybe longer. So if you want to take advantage of that, do that. It was gone for over 2.5 months. Prostagard, 10 powerful ingredients, 3 of them, one of the rarest things out there, even have the government admitting, yes, saw palmetto and these other ingredients really do help the prostate. That is their Prostagard. The best formula at the lowest price is available at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. We also have 25% off all the Molon Labe Made in America belt buckles, 10% off all the Second Amendment and pro-liberty and anti-globalist, anti-communist shirts. Great way to meet like-minded people and promote the truth. Got a lot of simple InfoWars.com shirts, high-quality, very inexpensive shortwave portable radio, solar-powered, non-GMO seeds for your garden and your fall garden coming up, and free shipping in the month of July. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Now, going back to Tosh Plumlee. Tosh Plumlee, again, run through Benghazi, why you've been a little bit upset about they're finally admitting a lot of it and then nothing's being done. And then let's get into El Chapo, the Mexican drug war, how all this ties together and where you think this country's going. And do you still have your Facebook up where you've been updating? I know it's been censored some and attacked some, so people can go read your questions for the government and other salient points.
Yes, Alex, I do. And thank you, by the way. Yes, I do have Robert Tosh Plumlee Facebook page. I've been pulling all this stuff together. and vetting it the best I can, and also other people that's in the military have been vetting some of the information to confirm it. Just before we went on break, I was talking about the statement that Senator McCain had made in reference to Stinger missiles. And first, I want to qualify something. I have absolutely no axe to grind with Senator McCain, and I have absolutely no axe to grind with Hillary Clinton. I do have an axe to grind when they sit and try to take shots at sitting military people, generals, colonels that know this information, and that's the reason that they have come out and contacted me. They can't come out, and some of them have, by the way, but they've lost their jobs. They've had IRS attack them. They've gone through the gamut. They've paid some dues and so like that. But anyway, I'm back to what the statement was about the Stinger missiles. I was privy to information about Stinger missiles being rerouted into ISIS hands through the direct commercial sales program that was monitored out of the U.S. State Department, also known as the Blue Lantern Report. Bill Conroy of Narco News had wrote an extensive article about the direct commercial sales program and how it works. I pulled all this information out together, put it in one place, put it out on Facebook page for any young cub reporters so that they could go out and investigate and vet the information for themselves. What we run into was the fact that there was 400 Stinger missiles missing that were shipped in C-130s through the direct commercial sales program to the Middle East. They were stored in places like Qatar, Jordan, and Turkey, and also some of them in Pakistan, and also some of them in other bunkers in Libya. Those places, they said, was overrun, but that's not true. Those weapons were also being assimilated to radical groups out of the Syrian deal. I devised 11 questions, asking questions about that. So anyway, get back to the Pig's Fly article. One of the reporters, and I think you have the clip of that, I don't know if you've got time to play it or what, but it's on my Facebook page, and it's about John McCain was being asked about the Stinger missiles. The reporter said 1,500. He made a mistake there. There was 1,500 weapons, and out of the 1,500 weapons that came from the direct commercial sales program monitored by the Blue Lantern Report overseen by the U.S. State Department, there was 400 Stinger missiles in there. Ambassador Stevens knew about this, and he had a deal worked out, was working a deal. Now, this is military intel, very sensitive information at that point in time, which I've already discussed 2 years ago, and it was put on ice. But anyway, he had obtained information, and he had a conduit to where he could buy back those Stinger missiles for $50,000 apiece to a radical group working in Libya. I went all over through this all 2 years ago and end up having the Department of Justice threatening me with a subpoena, and all they wanted was me to tell them where and how I received that information. They were not interested in investigating that information. So I went one step further, and I said, okay. I talked about Benghazi. I talked about ambassador approaching the U.S. State Department to buy back some of those weapons, especially the Stingers. Shortly after that, we got a helicopter shot down. They didn't admit it, but it was with a Stinger missile. We also, okay, McCain made a statement. Oh, yeah, where are you getting this information? Oh, it's erroneous information. I know these people. They're good people, you know.
And now he says it's a conspiracy theory. He never met with members of ISIS, but he's on video giving an award with Lindsey Graham to the current head of ISIS.
He simply controlled like a lot of the other people. He sold his soul to the damn devil, and that's as simple as that. I have nothing against McCain. But for him to sit there and make a statement when pigs fly, and then 2 weeks later, those missiles were marching on Baghdad, and they were photographed in the back of a brand new pickup truck with an American-made 50 caliber machine gun pointing skyward at a helicopter. Now, that's a fact. Now, McCain says, oh, yeah, Plumlee says, when pigs fly and the sun rises in the west. And he knows these people, and they're good people. All I know is that our American forces someday will be facing those Stinger missiles and helicopters, and it's already happened. Now, I don't want to get all excited.
We just lost.
Something goes against what this administration wants done. They label it as conspiracy. I am not a conspiracy freak, as they like to say. I am stating a fact. These facts that I'm telling to right on this camera right now came from the Pentagon, the U.S. Pentagon, through military sources that were active in that region. They reached out to me because they knew I would have the stuff in, under my armpit to go on camera and say, hey, this is what they told me. This is what you can vet. This is where you can go to vet it. And this is who you can talk to. All right, so I did that. I went into a warehouse in Mexico. I saw where the Mexican army was getting U.S. weapons, and they were passing those weapons to the
Sinaloa.
All right, that happened. That's a fact.
Well, it's now come out that the CIA was involved with Sinaloa and El Chapo. And let's talk about Chapo now.
All right, well, okay, we got the missile situation straightened out. Anyway, Ambassador Stevens, 2 weeks later, he was dead, along with his crew. All right, now let's talk about...
And that was done why, from your sources?
Say again? Because he was getting ready to blow the whistle on the fact that these weapons, 1,500 of them, was coming from C-130s.
Sure.
Authorized by the Direct Commercial Sales Program, which is monitored by the State Department, are supposed to be monitored by the State Department, circumnavigated Congress, and sent those weapons to Libya.
And sure, and then Hillary pulled Vince Foster on him and everybody else. Now, let's expand before we get into El Chapo and the other stuff you're on record to Congress with and the rest of it with Robert Tosh Plumlee. His Facebook is Robert Tosh Plumlee. So that's the proper Facebook for him. You can log in there and read it all. But Robert, I would recommend you make it public because you've got it where people got to be a member or logged in to get it. I would make it an open website to whoever administers that. You will get a tax and stuff on there, but who cares? I would just go ahead and open it up for everybody. But we've also mirrored the intel.
I thought my website, Facebook page was open up to everybody.
Used to be. It's on login now, but we'll check it. It's no big deal. We'll also mirror the latest info at InfoWars.com. But expanding on that, you were there in the late 50s. I mean, you're a famous guy for folks that are informed. For people that don't, people don't know who... You know, Chuck Yeager is an example I've used. They don't know who, anybody important was or is, because Chuck Yeager is alive. But, I mean, you're a famous guy in clandestine operations. You're in, as I said, dozens, more like hundreds of books. You were there flying arms into Fidel Castro. That's been declassified when he was a CIA operative. You have just been involved in all of it. You've blown the whistle major times, three times. It's amazing. Just retired a few years ago. That said, government, from my view, really has gotten more reckless and more out of control. I know I'm not lionizing government of the past, but the recklessness to give thousands of high-impact weapons, thousands of missiles, 400, 500 Stingers, other heat-seeking missiles, and I got this from Colonel Schaefer, by the way, pretty soon as well. I ran all this by him from you, and he said, yeah, that's what we're getting. And then he got called in and chewed out. That all the rebels, 99%, are al-Qaeda. ISIS is just their new name. Our government's funding them to destabilize the whole Middle East. I can't think of a time where our government funded radical, hardcore jihadis to overthrow our allies in Egypt, to butcher every Christian they can find, to blow up churches in Syria, to attack our own troops in Iraq. I mean, this is really a policy shift to do it so naked. I mean, they've done some bad stuff before, but... This is America really being the bad guy. So I want to ask you, why did Hillary and McCain and Obama and the people above them think they could get away with this? I mean, I guess they are, but it makes it even crazier, Tosh, that it's come out now and it's even admitted, and so is Fast and Furious and other things, and nobody gets in trouble. What does that say, Tosh?
Well, all right, here's the problem. We, American citizens, have been desensitized to the point to where we don't expect any more coming out from our government, because we've been desensitized to the point to where we simply say among ourselves, there's nothing we can do about it. So we are split. Diversions are run rampart. Every time something gets ready to pop open that's going to be earth-shattering, an illegal operation that they're involved with, something else comes up. They call them false flags, whatever they want to call them, conspiracies and all that. So then the emphasis goes off into that. It's all in what someone does with their pee-pee or whatever. There's something else comes up that takes the focus especially from a young generation, away from the actual illegal acts that this administration is doing. Bottom line, it's all about international gun running, because guns is more profitable than drugs. We've had guns and drugs, drugs and guns. International gun running has been alive and well, and I've posted this 1,000 times on my Facebook page. I've looked at people straight in the eye and say, hey, you asked me why, what, where? It's all about international gun running. We have an operation. We had it in the 50s. We run guns to Cuba. We run guns to Fidel Castro before he was dead. We did that. I've been all part of that. The only reason that I ever started talking in the first place was to protect my butt, get the information out there before the fact, put as much sunshine as I possibly can on it, and then let them come and take their best shot at me, which has happened many times. And thank the good Lord I've survived up until whatever. But anyway, it's not about me. It's about the operation. So it's international gun running. Now, the Stinger missiles, the death of Benghazi, the death of Brian Terry, the Border Patrol guy, all this Fast and Furious, all this stuff gets pushed to the back pages by mainstream media. And also, like I said, good reporters that do have the story, that all do work for the mainstream media, they cannot get their stories vetted and passed their senior editors that are on the take with various administrations politically. So it's a political thing, which now the people, us, our American citizens, have been desensitized to the point that we don't expect any more from our government other than corruption. And we get a new senator in there, and he talks, and he's going to do this, he's going to do that. We get a new congressman in there, he's going to do this, he's going to do that. But he gets in with that environment, and there's not a damn thing he can do.
Sure, let me expand on this. I know where Gary Webb and knew him. I was going to work with him on a new website. He was coming on the show. He told friends and family, people are breaking into my house, I'm getting followed by feds or PIs. And then they killed him, shot him twice in the head, and then had folks say he committed suicide. Stole his motorcycle, everything else. And he had a new book coming out that was going to prove everything. But, of course, that got killed. It came out later, and it's in the film Kill the Messenger, that I found nauseating because it was like watching reality, even look like Gary Webb, Kill the Messenger. And in Kill the Messenger, it breaks down the government drug dealing, all of it. And it turns out that the editor of the LA Times that killed the story, that ran stories demonizing Webb, was CIA. So that just shows you. But how do these guys sit there in the CIA and destroy a good reporter that tells the truth? How do they rationalize all this, bringing drugs into America and all this crap? I mean, because the people I've known that were in the CIA were incredibly patriotic, Mr. America types. Same thing with the FBI. But then at the top of the FBI, it's Holder. I mean, it's just such a parallax view. What do you think's going on?
Well, that's what I've been saying. In other words, infiltration. In other words, this takes years to infiltrate pocket people into these strategic positions. If you notice, not just this Obama administration, but other administrations have taken their cronies and nepotism and put these people that are not qualified and put them in very strategic positions to where they can control those that want to do something. For instance, when I was active, I got a lot of heat politically because I wasn't supposed to know certain things. I'm an inquisitive person. I like to find out everything has a beginning. Everything has the nuclei. Everything starts from one little kernel of something, where it be a seed or what. I'm the type of guy, I like to go back and find out where that seed started from. Well, that's a no-no in black ops today. The people I work with at the beginning were...
Stay there. Your Skype's cutting out. We're going to come right back. We're going to do some overdrive, too. We've got a six-minute segment, a five-minute segment, and then expanded live overdrive in the fourth hour for stations that carry. Well, Tosh Plumlee's a very credible whistleblower and investigative journalist. You can look him up in the Iran-Contra hearings. You can look him up in the church hearings. Just retired in the last few years. I know when I first had him on, he was on a phone on a C-130, getting ready to launch as soon as they were done with the call. But he's now retired, and it's just frustrating to watch them kill the ambassador and give the weapons to al-Qaeda, to then go overthrow regimes that aren't our enemies. I mean, it's just to see our government doing evil, illegal stuff. is sickening. So you got cut off by the break, sir. You were getting into the points about all this. We haven't gotten into El Chapo yet. He's big in the news right now. Can we talk about that drug war and what you know about that in Mexico?
Well, okay, what I know about that is before he was even captured, and they were looking for him, and the task force that I was talking about back when Brian Terry was killed, and the Fast and Furious situation with Holder was a cutout person for that, you know, in order to protect the administration from their illegal acts and so on like that. Okay, what I do know about that is the weapons, again, it's all the whole thing that we're talking about is based on international gun running, period. It doesn't matter where it's the Middle East or to Mexico. Now, as far as Guzman is concerned, Chapo, I mean, my gosh, he's been sitting out, he and Carl Quintero running around down there. I mean, geez, it's predictable exactly what was going on. The CIA basically protects these people. They've got too much to lose. Now, there's good people in the CIA, and they know this, but they can't come out. So they use nominees like myself and others, like the colonel that you mentioned earlier. These people, if they're still engaged and active in military ops or border patrol or whatever, they can't talk. Others, if they talk, they jeopardize their pension and they get IRS all over them, and then they get diverted into a thousand different things where they've got to stand up and waste all their time defending themselves through character assassination. And I know firsthand about character assassination. They don't kill you so much nowadays as much as they go out and use the media, mainstream media, to character assassinate you and use paid programmer people to go out.
Yeah, let me just throw this out because it's happening to me, and I don't mind it. I expect it because the message gets out. But they now have local radio where I live, but also I've learned all over the country because they know local media is more trusted now than dominant media. People know it's lying. So when MSNBC or CNN lies about me, everybody loves me. So they basically have a talking point, we've now confirmed, going out to all the local stations to misrepresent what I have to say. Well, Alex is glad the Sandy Hook kids died, or Alex thinks there's martial law this summer, and watch it not happen, he'll be discredited. That's the new talking point, and they are assassinating me right now with people that don't know who I am. So they'll just remember that's the guy that likes to kill children. I mean, it's sick to watch it happen.
Well, welcome to the club, Alex. I mean, that's the price that you have to pay. Both of us have to pay. All of us type have to pay if we're going to get the truth about what this is, what this corrupt government is doing. All this, look, we are witnessing a dog and pony show launched, programmed, and produced out of Washington, D.C., the ivory towers of those sacred halls there, you know, and they honestly think, they're so arrogant, that they honestly think that they have the American people desensitized to such a degree that there's not a damn thing we can do about it. We can sit here and talk about it, but then we get labeled as conspiracy. We can sit here and bring it up and vet it from a thousand different sources, but the character assassination is there. I've had a lot of good friends that's paid the ultimate price.
Let's talk about that back in 60 seconds. But there's a way around this. There's a certain point where the corruption gets so big, it's got
to
fall.
You are listening.
So
to
I want
to
talk about that back in 70 seconds.
Visit GCNLive.com today.
Fourth hour overdrive, folks. You want to stay with us? InfoWars. An incredible article from RT, and I'm well aware of this. 238,000 U.S. veterans died waiting for health care. Leaked document. Document also shows poor record keeping at the agency. Now, their job is to not give them treatment. And the documents come from the VA itself. This is confirmed. They now have computers telling folks who to not give treatment to. I mean, this is sick. And it's going to get worse. This is, anyways, Robert Tosh Plumlee. His Facebook's Robert Tosh Plumlee. We've got to have him back again for a full hour soon to take your calls. A true hero. Because in a world of cowards, men that just are men become heroes. And you've got the last 5 minutes here. Get into the friends you've had that have lost their lives, paid the ultimate price, tell the truth. And then I wanted to just mention that there comes a point in the graph where corruption gets so bad that it ends up falling in on itself because things just stop working and just start crumbling. And I think we're going to that point, so don't get too pessimistic. The arrogance of tyrants always begets their fall. Go ahead.
I agree with you. The sleeping giant is waking up. I find that out in my travels. Now, you know, we're getting a little scattered out there. You asked me about Carl. Okay, CIA had memos, good CIA people had memos that this was predictable as much as, hell, even before he got arrested. This has been a planned program. Here's the main reason. There's two drug lords out there that they say we are requesting extradition on them. We have talked about it, but we have not filed formal papers to Mexico. The reason that we have not filed formal papers to Mexico for these two drug lords' extradition is because if they come back and talk to a federal judge, they would tell where campaign contributions went to this country and where and how they bought military weapons from the direct commercial sales program and how they had inside information even before our intelligence operatives got it. So what I'm basically saying here, and I'm going to try to sum it up fast because I know we're short on time.
By the way, Tosh, that was a year after we broke it, even in the Chicago Tribune and the El Paso Times, that the number two of the Sinaloa gang was extradited to Chicago. He went and told the judge, I'm national security agent, gave his code. He was actually an agent of the CIA, and they released him. I mean, that was in the news.
Look, they covered that one up. That's a lower level than what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, and I'll specifically look straight in the camera and say it. Oh, was that, you know, whatever. Carl Quintero. Oh, I know the guy. Chapo. We cannot afford to make formal requests. All we can do is...
Sir, your Skype broke up when you started talking about El Chapo. Did you say you know El Chapo?
I know all those guys in one form or another, put it that way. And they know me in one form or another. And we have a standoff since agreement. We don't get in each other's ballpark, and I'm not getting in their ballpark, and they're not getting in mine. We're playing a tit for tat out here. Now, what I was getting ready to say, maybe I'm out of school again. I stepped over the line again, but here's the point. Those men cannot be brought to this country, and I'll sum it up just as tight as I can, because if we put them in front of a federal judge, it will be put on the record that they have made campaign contributions into political parties in this country, and they have bought weapons through the open direct commercial sales and financed their cartel with U.S.-made weapons. That was almost broken in the Fast and Furious, and Zimbada also in Chicago tried to talk to a federal judge, and they put a gag order around me, and mainstream media did not cover it. Now, that's how it's played. These guys, it was predictable. And I'm not trying to rant and get up on a soapbox here. I'm just trying to tell you a straight fact, eyeball to eyeball to you, Alex, on this program. This was predictable. It was known about. The CIA had information that this was an ongoing operation, and they have let those guys out because they cannot afford to file formal papers to Mexico. The mainstream media reports this. They say Mexico does not cooperate with us. We have not made a formal request for either one of those guys.
Incredible. It's a CIA drug running, gun running operation. Tosh Plumlee, incredible info. We'll talk to you again very, very soon. Thank you so much.
And welcome back to the special Overdrive Hour here. I'm Leanne McAdoo, helming the ship. Coming up later in the show, Jakari Jackson will be joining me to talk about a shock video. A top Planned Parenthood director admits on film to selling hearts, livers, and skulls of dead babies. It's absolutely repugnant. That's coming up later in the show. But first, we wanted to get to this interview that we did on the InfoWars Nightly News. We thought this was very important to show you because this affects every American that is out there. Basically, you have federal agencies that are circumventing the laws. They are illegally obtaining information, using it to frame people, prop up these fake cases. And there's also evidence that they are trained to lie under oath about where they're getting this information in order to protect their sources. And of course, these are, you know, information that they're getting from fusion centers and things like that. And also really important to introduce a new term called parallel construction. And parallel construction is basically the term where federal law enforcement agencies are teaching their agents to fabricate evidence and commit perjury if that's necessary in order to protect and conceal the illegal sources of their investigations. So incredibly important information here. I was speaking with former IRS Special Agent Joe Bannister and Attorney Robert Bernhoft, and Attorney Bernhoft is the one that is spearheading this jaw-dropping case against the IRS and Department of Justice, a huge misconduct lawsuit. So here's that report. Now, we're all well aware of rampant misconduct within our federal agencies. Just off the top of my head, I can think of the IRS targeting conservative groups and then destroying any evidence of that, destroying the servers after they were subpoenaed. We've got the Department of Justice being complicit in shipping guns across the border, Operation Fast and Furious. Former Attorney General Eric Holder was held in contempt of Congress. And, you know, nothing ever happened to him. Now he's at a cushy job at a law firm. So these are just a few of the examples of how our federal agencies are really dealing with their own set of rules. Now, joining me in studio, former IRS Special Agent Joe Bannister and Attorney Robert Bernhoft. Now, gentlemen, you really have kind of discovered evidence of kind of some secret police activities here. Legitimately, we are dealing with agencies on operating under their own set of rules.
Yeah, that's right, Leanne. It is a sort of American secret police using illegally obtained secret evidence against American citizens and then lying and concealing the fact that they've done it. What's happening, and we have a case in Atlanta, Georgia, where we filed a federal civil rights complaint alleging that it's the first such case of its kind in the country in federal court. And Joe is helping assist with his experience as a former special agent, decoding some of the reports and putting his fine eye on it. But here's what's happening. It's taken a turn for the worse, in addition to the things you've described. Federal law enforcement agents are now able to tap into a super double secret database of illegally obtained materials, foreign intel, illegally obtained wiretaps, unconstitutionally obtained statements from confidential informants, and this whole Pandora's box of illegal material. They're able to tap into it and then use it to start investigations against American citizens. It gets worse from there. They're then officially trained, and we brought with us to the studio today an actual page from the Internal Revenue Manual where IRS special agents are actually trained on how to fabricate what they call parallelly construct an alternative origin of the investigation and source so that they can conceal the fact that they've tapped into the illegal Pandora's box. And then finally, they're authorized and trained to commit perjury, to file false affidavits, and even to lie to federal judges and juries if called upon to keep the whole program a secret.
Wow. So all things that if you or I were to conduct ourselves this way, we'd be serving years, lifetime in prison. And they're basically being trained in how to operate under this different sort of jurisdiction here. So tell me a little bit, what is this parallel construction?
Yes, the parallel construction aspect, it's an actual official program, and it's present in all of the federal law enforcement agencies. Reuters was able to find a document from 2004, which demonstrates that IRS special agents particularly were trained in parallel construction. And what it means is, if I'm a special agent, like Joe used to be, rather than just do the hard investigative work to detect criminal activity, I can tap into what's called the OSIDEF Fusion Center at an undisclosed location on the East Coast. And they will feed me data that they think is relevant, let's say, to my Atlanta area of jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. This is all illegally and unconstitutionally obtained information. I start an investigation. Now I'm trained that I can never reveal where I got that information from. So I have to fabricate an alternative scenario. For example, Reuters used an example. Let's say that there's a tip that there's a semi-truck driving through Texas and there's a foreign wiretap obtained illegally that suggests there's drugs on that semi-truck. Well, the state troopers will stop that truck, but afterwards they have to lie about the fact that they got that illegal tip. And so they'll create an alternative reality, such as, there was a broken taillight, or, we saw the driver swerve across the white line or the median line. And so these special agents are being trained to lie and deceive and conceal. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for a long time. I've done a number of misconduct cases. I've never seen anything quite like this. It's shocking.
Right. And a lot of people might say, well, who cares? You know, they're catching terrorists. They're catching these criminals that are shipping drugs across the border, things like that. But we're actually hearing now they're using this in the civil asset forfeiture cases. So just your average American could be targeted with this, and they don't even know how or why they were tipped off or why they got pulled over. And we have cases where there was a young man on a train who had $12,000 taken from him on the spot because he had cash, and that was his money. But, you know, the cop decided that he obtained it illegally, so now he has to go through the process and, you know, show how he came across that cash and all of that. So this does affect an average American. So this is important. It's not just, oh, well, who cares? They're terrorists.
It always starts with the best stated intentions. The Organized Crime Drug Enforcement Task Force, which Joe used to be affiliated with as a special agent, it started off to get the really bad guys, syndicated narco-terrorists, violent international drug gangs. And so that's how the Special Operations Division Parallel Construction Program started. But immediately they expanded it to organized crime and money laundering. And now we know from our Atlanta federal civil rights suit that we investigated for 5 years before we brought the suit that they're targeting ordinary Americans who are not even accused of being organized crime figures. Mm-hmm. They have no involvement with money laundering. Jerry Marshalletta Jr. ran a successful drywall company. It's just, they tell us one thing, they get everybody on board. Okay, we're going to go after the really bad guys, dangerous individuals.
Right.
And then they use that Pandora's box information and they can go after any American with this material. Mm-hmm. And they'll lie about it.
Right. Well, I know just for myself personally, you know, years ago when I heard of them going and scanning your emails and things, it was to find pedophiles. And you think, oh, well, that's great. I don't want anyone, you know, passing along child porn and stuff. But it's not. It goes so much deeper than that. And you're right. They're always kind of saying it's for to catch the ultimate bad guy, but it's really for the average American. And so now this OSDEF Fusion Center, Organized Crime Drug Enforcement Task Force, this is fusion centers. I mean, these are all across the United States now set up after 9/11. Is this a specific one or?
Yes. This is a specific fusion center where Drug Enforcement Administration, DEA, and their Special Operations Division, I know there's a lot of acronyms, mm-hmm. SOD, they have a special secret location where they have the DICE database and the Compass software computer system. And this is a special database that is used for parallel construction. It's the nexus of all of the materials that are then leaked out into all cities and districts throughout the country. And this is what IRS agents and FBI agents are tapping into. It's notable that, as Reuters reported last year, there was a case where a high-level policymaker at the Department of Justice actually made a secret visit to a federal district court judge's chambers 2 days before a trial started, showed him some SOD parallel construction evidence from Pandora's box, and got the judge to sign a secret order barring the defense lawyers or the prosecutor from seeing the material. This came out on appeal where the Third Circuit Court of Appeals discovered this. They were shocked and horrified, and they issued a notice that this had to be briefed. But the idea that an executive branch official from Department of Justice would violate federal law and go into a judge's chambers ex parte, that's a federal crime, and get the judge to sign a secret order in an open domestic case. When the FISA courts were established, Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act courts, secret courts, they said, don't worry about the secret court proceedings. These are terrorists. Well, that sounds like FISA to me. And even in FISA, the government puts a public notice out that they're going to use secret evidence. So terrorists in FISA courts can have more rights than American citizens right now as to how this is being operated on the ground.
Mm. Okay, now we're going to cut this right here. We'll have a little bit more after the news. But Joe, I wanted to ask you, why is this so important that we understand that there are IRS agents utilizing this? And this particular document, you said, is no longer in their manual.
Well, as most Americans probably know, the IRS is an information gathering agency, and they want to know everything about you so that they can, you know, tax you not only maybe what you've paid on your tax return, but much, much more. The problem is that this kind of a procedure, it's actually geared towards taking down a great deal of people and using the fact that most cases plead out. You never get to trial where some of this stuff would be discovered. And most Americans are going to be in that boat. Wow. Right? Like, wow, I'm facing, you know, X number of decades in prison, X hundred thousands of fines. They're giving me a great deal. And so it enables them, because of the existing plea bargaining system, I'm not saying you don't plea bargain, but the fact that it's so prevalent, mm-hmm. to actually help them to cover this up.
Wow.
And so, you know, working at the IRS, so now in the last century, back in 1999, I was floored back then in seeing what I was seeing. And now I hope that enough Americans are going to be like, okay, we all got to get going on this and put a stop to this. This is nasty stuff.
Right. Absolutely. And we've heard of stories where people will actually take the plea because they don't have the money to fight the case. And so maybe they're not even guilty, but they'll just accept the plea deal. You're telling me that they are committing perjury under oath.
Yes, but originally, of course, they said they wouldn't do that. When Reuters reporters contacted Department of Justice and DAA people, they said, wait a minute now. If it doesn't plead out, we'll dismiss before trial. We would never have our special agents take the stand, swear to tell the truth, and then commit perjury before a jury. We would just dismiss it. That turns out to be a lie. Mm. And we know that because of our investigation into the Marshalletta case in Northern District of Georgia, and we filed a complaint there in early May. We'll get to discovery in a couple months. We'll be able to depose all these people. But during this trial, an ICE and Customs special agent and an IRS special agent committed streaming perjury regarding the source and the origin of the investigation. And we can prove that through about 100,000 pages of documents that we've diced together. So this isn't speculation. These aren't allegations. We can prove exactly where they got the information from and how they committed perjury to conceal it. So again, the government says, well, maybe you have questions about what we're doing here, but be sure we would never go into a trial setting before an Article III federal district court judge, before a jury, with a man or woman's liberty on the line. We would never commit perjury to protect OSADEF SOD parallel construction information. And they're lying about that as well, because they do it. They do it every day of the week, and they did it in the Marshalletta case.
And then, so in that case, let's see, who are we? There are many agencies, ICE, IRS, FBI agents, prosecutors, and a sitting federal judge.
Yes, one of the former prosecutors, Justin Anand, was then made a United States magistrate judge. Mm. It turns out that all the people that conspired to try and destroy Jerry Marshalletta, his father, his family, and the company he built over 20, 30 years, they were all promoted. It's just perverse.
Wow.
ICE Special Agent Sellers got a cherry job in D.C. in international operations. IRS Special Agent in Charge, Andre Martin, he was promoted. He is in District of Columbia with a nice, excellent job up there. Former Prosecutor Anand was made a U.S. Magistrate Judge. Everybody did well by conspiring to violate the Marshalletta's rights. And they all did well for keeping the secret. And that's what it was about. They lied, they fabricated evidence, they committed perjury to keep secret the origin of the false information against Jerry.
And can you explain to me a little bit about the Marshalletta case, just so we can see how anyone could see themselves in this situation?
Yes. Jerry owns a drywall company, and he was secretly investigated for about 5 years. In 7 years after the investigation started, he was indicted on tax charges. They were trumped up. There were no tax violations. I'm a criminal tax lawyer. I know a criminal tax case. And so it started in 1999. It didn't end until 2012. We came in after the trial, got all the convictions reversed on appeal, and then the government decided to retry the whole case. So we filed another motion alleging outrageous government misconduct. The judge finally dismissed the case in September 12th of 2012, just about a couple of years ago. And I've talked to Jerry over the years, and he's a rational, reasonable person, but he told me, people need to know what they did to me and my family so it doesn't happen to other people. File the suit. And so that's what brings us here today.
Wow. And Joe, is this something that you've come across before, people being kind of taken to the cleaners in this and just getting it drawn out year after year so that finally they'll just, you know, they won't have the money or the wherewithal to be able to continue on?
Unfortunately, they were called stats, you know, short for statistics in the government. And the better your stats, the better budget you would get, you know, the next year, the more promotions. It's really all based on stats. And so if you have tools like this, as illegal as they might be, and they raise your stats, you're looking pretty and you're getting more promotions and transfers and you're just looking really good to the government bureaucracy. So I did see that, and it's continuing. It's just that now they're getting even more brazen. Before, it might, well, we'll do some mostly legal stuff, or, you know, we'll do things according to Hoyle. But now they're taking bedrock principles like telling the truth on the witness stand. And you know what? It used to be bedrock, but we don't really need that anymore, because look at the stats we can get, and look how many people we get to plead out, and no one will ever know. It's a great system. And that's what I believe the thought process is there. And they lose touch with the real world, mm-hmm. where those of us who get under investigation, as I've been, and Bob helped me, you know, actually had the resources to be acquitted as I deserved. But most Americans don't have those resources, mm-hmm. and it is just unconscionable. But all those Americans, before they get fingered with this stuff, we need to all join together and clean house.
Right. And most people might not even be aware that these type of programs exist to be able to have their attorney say, how did you come across this, you know, evidence? Where did you, how did you build your case and all of that? So kind of like that don't ask, don't tell. If they don't ask, well, then they're not technically lying about mm-hmm. it or withholding any information. Well, so what specifically can people do right now? I mean, this is huge. And so you're saying this is probably the first case of its kind that's going to really expose this activity. Where do we go from here?
This case, to our knowledge, is the first case in the country that alleges this type of perjury, fabrication of evidence, all pursuant to the parallel construction issue. We suspect there are hundreds, if not thousands, of others. But as you say, Leanne, if the defendants and the defense lawyers don't even know that this exists or could exist, they don't even know what questions to ask. And defense lawyers are telling me, well, now that we know about parallel construction, we kind of know what questions to ask, but we have no idea in our case if it was used. So we sent a letter to the prosecution saying, gosh, guys, did you violate the Constitution and laws of the United States and use the Pandora's box, OSADEF Fusion Center materials against my client? And you could imagine the prosecutor sends a letter back and says, gosh, no.
Yeah.
Well, where do you go from there? What process do they have to compel on oath representations and statements about that? And even if you compel it on oath, as evidenced by the Marshalletta trial in 2007, if you could call it a trial, they lie on oath.
Right.
So this is deeply troubling. What I would ask people to do is just to stay abreast of the developments in this area. Go back and read the Reuters articles from 2014 and August, from August 5 to about August 29th. They're relatively short. They're concise. They also have published the Internal Revenue Manual section that trains the IRS agents to do it. And keep track of the Marshalletta case. The Marshallettas could use some support in this. They've been fighting this fight for 15 years. And just people dropping them a line and saying we support your efforts would be helpful.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You agree with that? Any closing words for the average American out there?
Well, you know, the info warriors know what they're doing when it comes to spreading the word about things. And so you can... You know, we've used a lot of acronyms, and this is all new. I've heard Alex talk about this a number of times, David mm-hmm. Knight, many of the people here. So the concept is not new. Maybe some of the details are. Mm-hmm. But these people were wronged, the Marchalettas, and they are. There's a lot more that have been wronged that don't have the resources. So if you have a friend or a relative who's an attorney, mention the word parallel construction and have them watch this news show and, you know, start to spread the word. And I think the word will spread fast, especially in D.C.
Yes.
Well, a lot of people didn't even know civil asset forfeiture existed in that program, or even Edward Snowden and everything that he revealed. So that was just a couple of years ago. We had no access to that information, and we have been conspiracy theorists for years. And now it's, you know, here we have proof, we have evidence. And so hopefully this can be the beginning of dismantling all of that misconduct that's rampant right now in our federal government.
We're hopeful and grateful for the opportunity to talk about it tonight.
Yeah, thank you.
We remarked about how pieces, you get more pieces to the puzzle. Like, oh,
yeah.
Now I see how this fits here. And so we just, you know, Bob's doing an amazing job in putting a lot more puzzle pieces into the puzzle.
Right. And that's really what it's all about, is just shining the light. And even if it's just little pieces, now we have a new piece of the puzzle. So thank you guys so much. We appreciate it. And there you go, folks. Our federal agencies are dealing with an entirely different set of rules than the rest of us. That's the real us versus them. But they want us fighting amongst ourselves about flags.
We're on the march.
And welcome back to the second half of the Overdrive Hour. You're watching the Alex Jones Show, and I'm Leanne McAdoo hosting. Joining me now is Jakari Jackson. Jakari, you know, I wanted to get you in here because we have some breaking news. A really disgusting video is making the rounds now on the internet. If you want to check out the article, it's up on Infowars.com. Adon Salazar has wrote it. It's called Caught on Tape. Planned Parenthood doctor admits to selling aborted baby body parts.
It's it's quite the headline, but it's also quite true. Adon told me about this article a little bit earlier in the day when he was, you know, compiling all of his statements here. And when he first told me about it, this even before I saw the video, I just couldn't believe that this was actually happening and true. Because, you know, of course, we know was the abortionist Kermit, you know, he was caught doing all kinds of things. His aides came out and spoke out against those type of incidents. And you'd like to think that this is just a one-off type of deal. But as we see with this article and some of the things we've seen before, it's not the case. These things continue to happen. And as horrific as they are, it sounds like something out of a horror movie. But these are things that are happening right here in the United States of America.
Right. And that's exactly how I felt when I saw this video. It was unbelievable to me, and it did make me tear up. I got a big lump in my stomach. But let me just kind of tell you a little bit about, it's a hidden camera video. It's coming out of Los Angeles, and it features the senior director of medical services there at Planned Parenthood. So this is not just some rogue Planned Parenthood worker. This is like a top down directive here. It's Dr. Deborah Nucatola. Might not be saying that right. But anyway, so she is caught on camera discussing the practice of selling these body parts of aborted babies. This is in blatant violation of federal law. And this is part one of a three-part documentary series that's coming from the Center for Medical Progress. So they've got this undercover footage. And here you'll be able to view that video if you go to Infowars.com. Adon has the video embedded in his article. So you can watch that in full there. It's got subtitles as well. But the senior director is explaining to a male and female couple over lunch how the procedure goes down and which human organs are most popular.
And when you watch this video, they explain it so calmly. Mm-hmm. The senior director does. And it's almost like they're talking about harvesting chickens or cows or something to that regard. Talking right. about, well, the organs of the liver and the heart and all these other things. It's just so calm and like she's, you know, done it before. And it's a very disturbing, disgusting video.
Right. Well, let's go ahead and play some of that now.
Now a story we guarantee most of you have never heard before. Big money is being made from the sale of fetal body parts.
Even the most ardent pro-choice advocates, like Planned Parenthood
video
President
from 2000,
Gloria
actually, they started the film with it, where they're...
It seems inappropriate, totally inappropriate. Where there is wrongdoing, it should be prosecuted and should be brought to justice.
So those are clips from 2000 on the news. And here, this is actually now undercover Planned Parenthood admitting it. So obviously you might find some of the content disturbing.
Exact parts these days, they're looking for specific notes, AB notes, SA. I was like, wow, I didn't even know. Good for them.
Good
yes,
for them.
The first time she said people wanted longer. And then, but like I said, always as many intact livers as possible. People just want.
Yeah, livers.
People want lower extremities too.
Lower extremities.
I mean, that's easy. I don't know what they're doing with it. I guess they want muscle.
Yeah, a dime a dozen.
Okay, let's pause that video right there and just, so that's what you were describing, Jakari. So here she's talking about people, they want livers and they want fully intact hearts because they need all the nodes for the hearts. And she's like shoving salad in her mouth and drinking her wine. And it totally reminds me of that scene out of Silence of the Lambs when Dr. Lecter is talking about eating the guy with like fava beans and a Chianti. I mean, that's what that lady reminds me of, just discussing this.
Yeah, absolutely. It's quite, you know, like I said, disturbing to see such a thing. But that's the temperament of how calmly these people can describe some of these things. And to all these people who say that aborted or a child in the womb isn't a person, well, you can hear in this clip this woman talking about how you can clearly identify the heart, the liver, the lungs, all these vital body parts, but you know, you can identify that as human body parts, but they want to say that the child is not a human being.
Right, exactly. And this is the big deal with these late term abortions. I mean, there's like big money for them in this. I mean, here she doesn't really talk about some of those prices. You know, they might not get that much for it, but the hospitals themselves that are dealing in these transplants and things, they are making hundreds of thousands of dollars off of this. So the video goes on, you hear them talking, we'll go ahead and play it, but they're describing how this is in total violation of federal law. It's against the law here in America to sell human body parts. But then they're kind of discussing how they're getting around that. So go ahead and play that. So the commercial trafficking body parts from an aborted baby punishable by up to 10 years in prison or a fine of up to $500,000. Now, this is an actual order form where you can order. They're showing an order form. You can say, what type of tissue would you like to order? What's the, you know, what age? And now they're sort of talking about how they go undercover. They're posing as a fetal tissue procurement company.
Mm-hmm.
So
I'm the medical director for the national office for all the affiliates. So I say, okay, what are you looking to supply today? We've been very good at getting hearts, lung, liver.
So in the fact that they're so nonchalant, you can you basically know that this isn't the first time she's had this conversation with people.
Every provider has had patients who want to donate their tissue, and they absolutely want to come with them. They just want to do it in a way that is not perceived as this clinic is selling tissue, this clinic is making money off of this.
Okay,
so
money.
When you are or the affiliate is determining what that is monetary.
Yes.
So then it doesn't raise any question of this is what it's about. This is the thing. What price range would you?
So right now they're explaining the process.
Out. I would say it's probably anywhere from $30 to $100, depending on the facility and what's involved.
The $30 to $100 price, or that's per specimen that we're talking about, right? Yeah.
Yes.
The $30 to $100 price, or that's per specimen that we're talking about, right? Yeah.
Yes.
How much of a difference can that actually make if you know what kind of what's expected or what we need versus?
It makes a huge difference. I'd say a lot of people want liver.
Mm-hmm.
And for that reason, most providers would do this case under ultrasound guidance.
Mm-hmm. So maybe we can pause it right there and talk about how she has a hot list. You know, a lot of people want the liver, they want the heart, you know, and what exactly they're going to do with these things, we don't know, but it's, you know, quite disgusting to see them so nonchalantly talk about these things as if, you know, it's just like a part of a chicken or a harvested cow.
Right. And she talks, now she's going to go on to say, you know, how they go about procuring these organs, because here we're talking about a tiny little baby.
Mm-hmm.
And so she's talking about the procedure and how they have to use a certain type of forceps method so they can get the heart, the lung, the liver without crushing that part. So they want to be sure they can, you know, get it all out without damaging these very important.
They don't want to damage the tissue of the baby. You know, they're quite adamant about that. They want it in the most pristine condition so that anybody who would view this and see how they try to profit off of your child, your aborted child. So it's not just, you know, they take it and whatever people think the disposal method for it is. No, they are repurposing your child to sell it to very strange people.
Right. And she's also now talking about how they circumvent there's that little gray area where they're like, well, you know, it's against the law to sell mutilated dead baby parts, essentially. And so now she's going to kind of get into say how they get around that. And you know, as long as they didn't intentionally, in quotes, so go ahead and roll.
$100 price, or that's per specimen that we're talking about, right? Yeah.
Yes.
How much of a difference can that actually make if you know what kind of what's expected or what we need versus?
It makes a huge difference. I'd say a lot of people want liver.
Mm-hmm.
And for that reason, most providers would do this case under ultrasound guidance, so they'll know where they're putting their forceps.
takes a big dose of that wine.
Procedure is calvarium. The head is basically the biggest part. Most of the other stuff can come out intact.
Right.
It's very rare to have a patient that doesn't have it.
So getting the head is difficult, but
to bring the body cavity out exactly. Intact and all that.
So then you just kind of cognizant of where you put your breast first. You try to intentionally go above and below the thorax so that, you know, we've been very good at getting parts, lung, liver. Mm-hmm.
So this is, you know.
So I'm not.
Yeah, she's basically giving the play-by-play of how they go about
procuring, harvesting. This is not her first rodeo here with this. I mean, this is just disgusting. And the thing that's really shocking is that, you know, most of the time they will save the best for last. And this is the first little clip we're getting out of this upcoming documentary. This is so there's other clips that we don't even know what is about to be hitting.
Yeah, and we've seen things going on in other parts of the world. Like we have this article right here from the Business Insider. A British man was caught trying to smuggle a roasted baby fetus into Thailand. And, you know, that defies words in and of itself. But I think here in the States, we always like to pride ourselves. Well, maybe that's happening in the rest of the world, but that can never happen here. It's happening here.
Right.
And it has been happening here because, as you can see, it's, you know, it's like a farmer talking to somebody at the bait shop. You know, they know exactly what they're doing, how they're going about it. And it's very sad to see that this goes on. And kudos to the people that filmed the thing, because I really don't understand how you can sit there with a straight face. But, you know, they did what they had to do to get the video out.
Right. Absolutely. And there's another story out of the Daily Mail. Thousands of pills filled with powdered human baby flesh discovered by customs officials in South Korea. So, I mean, this is prize. These organs are like prized. Mm-hmm. I think people maybe think that these are like the youth elixir or something, that it's going to give them stamina and vigor. Who knows?
It's always those urban legend kind of deals. You know, eat the flesh of the babies and you'll live forever. And all types of bizarre things. I think it was David who did a report. I'm just going off the top of my head, talking about them using fetuses to, was it heat hospitals?
Yes, that came out last year that they were using their aborted fetuses to heat hospitals in the UK and Canada, I believe. So yeah, I mean, this is going on. It's disgusting. And here, this lady is so nonchalant describing exactly how this happens. And like we said, you know, this is a senior director of medical services, so she's not just some rogue agent there who's making a little money on the side. Mm-hmm. This is going on across the country. So no wonder they don't want to take out the partial birth abortions.
Well, the thing that you'll often run into when you know, talk to somebody about Planned Parenthood and you talk about the abortions and they say, well, abortions is only a small part of what we do. Well, I'm like, well, when people go out there and rally against you, they're not protesting the fact that you give out free pins and lollipops at the front desk. They're protesting the fact that you have abortions. And now we see what these abortions are turning into. Mm-hmm. They're turning into a meat market where they are literally selling body parts of dead children.
Right. And then it's like you see stuff like this and you wonder how that the one girl that was saying, you know, she was so proud of herself. Oh, I kill my kids that mm-hmm. we had at that abortion protest. And these are people that are self-proclaimed communists because they want to save the underdog and the underclass. And here it's like, who's the most that needs saving?
Oh yeah, that's a very good point, because they always, oftentimes these abortion clinics they'll be located in low-income neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. They have many minorities who go there and use their facilities, you know, other races as well. But, you know, it's always, you know, we're here to help you. We're here to help you do whatever you have to do. So they'll bring these people in, charge them what's like $300 or something around that price tag to have the baby aborted, but then they'll turn around and sell the aborted fetus for as much as they can get.
Leah, let's go ahead and play some more of this repugnant clip.
I'm going to crush that part. I'm going to basically crush below, I'm going to crush above, and I'm going to see if I get it intact. And with the calvarium, in general, some people will actually try to change the presentation so that it's not a vertex. So when it's a vertex presentation, you never have enough dilation in the beginning unless you have a real huge amount of dilation to deliver an intact calvarium. So if you do it starting from the breech presentation, there's dilation that happens as the case goes on, and often the last kind of evacuated intact calvarium.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, I mean, there are certainly steps that can be taken.
So they can convert to breech, for example,
exactly.
At the start of the...
Exactly.
Yeah, totally dangerous for the mom to have a breech birth. Women can die during childbirth. But here they're talking about how they flip it around so they can pull it out to get that fully intact head, because the calvarium is just so important.
And I definitely encourage everybody who's listening to this to go to InfoWars.com and watch these videos for yourself, because you can hear it. You know, it's a little distorted, but if you watch the video, you can see it along with the subtitles and see everything that's going on.
Yeah.
So definitely go to that. It says, caught on tape, Planned Parenthood doctor admits to selling aborted baby body parts. And that's on InfoWars.com, the article by Adan Salazar.
Yes, be sure to tweet that out, share it on Facebook, because people don't believe this kind of thing is happening. And this is just more fuel when you try to have a conversation with people about this. This is why this is so shocking, so repulsive.
Yeah, because, I mean, people see the stuff that we've put out, you know, like when we had the abortion rally or that lady who was running around the Texas Capitol talking about hell, Satan, and they think it's, you know, we cherry pick that stuff. This stuff happens a lot. And I'm not saying everybody who's pro-abortion is, you know, into selling babies, but it's not a once in a blue moon kind of deal.
Yeah.
You have some very odd characters. The freaks come out at night when you start to talk about abortion, whether it's people who want to sell babies, people who enjoy the act of killing their babies, you know, these people who, you know, love worshiping Satan and they kill babies. It's all type of weird degenerates come out to support abortion.
Right. And even if you're not, you know, you're not for it and you think, oh, well, I'm just going to go have an abortion and this isn't going to happen to me. You don't know what's happening to that fetus that comes out. I mean, you don't know what they're doing. And it's so even if you're not for it, it's happening anyway. And you really have no say in what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nor would they even admit it if it's not caught on tape here.
Right. Yeah, exactly what you said. If we did not have this clip, you know, it had never happened. Like, what's your proof of it? So that's the way they keep going about these things. And, you know, like I said, kudos to the people who shot this video to help explain to people exactly what's going on.
Yeah, absolutely. Like we said, be sure to share this at InfoWars.com. Share it on Twitter. Share it on Facebook. We absolutely appreciate all of your support. Thank you for tuning in to the show today for the special hour of Overdrive. I think Alex is going to start having us come on the show regularly in the Overdrive hour to get you all acquainted with us. If you are not a subscriber to Prison Planet, please do. You'll catch our nightly news every night at 7 p.m. Central, live. Thank you all.